Classic stamps at the plate, but Magadan's swing is an eye-popper. In the first two games of the College World Series, Magadan had eight hits. Now that was eight hits in a row, a record naturally. And with Magadan's hot bat, the Crimson Tide is undefeated. Alabama's opponent tonight, Texas, also undefeated, lives on pitching. Calvin Schiraldi, 13-2, was the number one pick in the draft by the New York Mets, while his teammate, who is Roger Clemens, also was picked number one in the draft by Boston. The Red Sox like his arm and like his statistics. Texas, in typical Longhorn tradition, has remained undefeated in the College World Series with that excellent pitching staff, plus timely hitting, such as this game won in the 11th inning against Oklahoma State, their rival. Texas will need that pitching, that timely hitting tonight, for Alabama is on a 15-game winning streak. A game of contrast in the College World Series, the Crimson Tide and the Longhorns. The Total Sports Network presents another NCAA championship, the 1983 College World Series. Tonight's telecast is being brought to you by Michelob Light, an exceptional light beer with a rich, smooth taste. And by Timex, timekeeper to ESPN. Timex, we make technology beautiful. Tonight, game 11. Texas, the Longhorns, number one in the country, 63-14. Against the Crimson Tide of Alabama, 45-9. The winner's bracket, neither team has lost. That will change later tonight. Rosenblatt Stadium, temperature game time is 86 degrees for this winner's bracket game. Hello, everyone. I'm Jim Simpson, and both teams, as we said, are undefeated. A fellow by the name of Casey Stengel once said, good pitching always beats good hitting, and vice versa. Think about that for a moment, because tonight we've got good hitting and good pitching. And Jerry Kindall, who twice has coached the Arizona team to this championship, I would say that being a conservative baseball man, which you may or may not be, that you would have to go with Casey Stengel. Not the vice versa, but good pitching does always beat good hitting.
Normally that's what happens, Jim, and tonight we'll see if that holds true. Alabama has hit well all season. They've lived by the sword. Tonight, they may die by the sword.
Thus far, in the College World Series, this is what Texas has done. Undefeated, of course, Texas wiped out James Madison 12-0 in round number one, and then held on that 11-inning job with Oklahoma State to win 6-5 in round two. As far as the Crimson Tide of Alabama, their first appearance in 33 years, they took Arizona State, one of the favorites, 6-5. And then in a game shown last night here on ESPN, or I should say night before last, they won another 6-5 victory. They are undefeated. And it is going to be Alabama and Texas. A loser tonight is still in there. And that's one of the good things. This is a double elimination tournament. So if you win tonight, you've got a couple of games and you can lose one more. But if you lose tonight, you can't afford to lose again.
That's right. The winner tonight will be in a very, very advantageous position to capture the NCAA title.
All right, we're going to take a close look at the players of Texas, the players of Alabama, when they come back to Rosenblatt Stadium. What a place to have the College World Series. And what a College World Series we are having this year. Defeated a possible championship to the winner of tonight's game. Certainly a leg up on the rest of the teams still remaining in this championship. Jerry Kindall, he loves to have a spark plug. He loves to have a team that gets them going with one man who can provide that spark. And Texas has that spark.
They sure do, Jim. Little Johnny Sutton, the Texas senior outfielder, is the young man who batted only 14 times this season before the regional tournament. An injury got him in the lineup, and he responded with a 10-for-22 performance and was selected MVP of the Central Regional.
And Texas also has a hitting first baseman.
Few players have captured the hearts of Texas fans like Jose Tolentino, the flashy first baseman from Mexico City. He already has set Texas season records for most at-bats and total bases. He's only one away from the doubles and home run mark for the University of Texas.
The mind-boggler to me is not who's going to win it. I wish is the bottom line. That's what everybody wants to find out. But how many hits is David Magadan going to get? 8 for 8 until he finally went down in his final at-bat in the second game.
David Magadan is one of the outstanding hitters we've ever seen here at the College World Series. He's mounted a .539 batting average for 1983, and that's no fluke, Jim. There are over 200 at-bats and 94 RBIs in these incredible hitting statistics.
And the other man that you've got to talk about when you talk about Alabama?
Brett Elbin. This tough little senior third baseman is the spark plug that ignites the fearsome Alabama hitting attack. He's hitting .345, has a record-breaking 64 walks. No wonder he's leading the Crimson Tide with 86 runs scored, another school record for Alabama.
And we'll talk more about them and a lot of others as we go along, but we're not the only people who are going to be talking about them. Several of our ESPN colleagues are down on the field. We begin with Jim Price.
Thank you, Jim. You know, the Texas Longhorn coach, Cliff Gustafson, decided to go with Steve LeBay tonight, even though Calvin Schiraldi, one of his ace starting pitchers, is ready to go. I think a very important key tonight for Texas is how well Jeff Heron, the catcher, works with this young left-hander. He's starting him to try to neutralize the Alabama power from the left side. That'll be a big task for Jeff Heron. Now I think Irv Brown has something about the Crimson Tide.
Hey, thank you, Jim. I do. You know, Rob Skates is the 4-0 hitter for Alabama. He's had a tough time in the regional, in the College World Series, but he's got good power. He is capable of hitting the ball over the wall. He's a fearless outfielder. If he'll get off to a good start and see the ball, that's been his big problem. He'll help this ball club. Watch Rob Skates, the 4-0 hitter, 4-hole hitter tonight. Let's go back upstairs to Jim Simpson.
All right, Irv and Jim, we'll be checking back in with you, and we're going to go away, but when we come back, we're going to give you that starting lineup for the Longhorns of Texas, the number one team in the country. Face Alabama in just a few moments. 23rd College World Series appearance, more than any other team in college baseball. Bill Bates will lead it off and play second base, bothered with a bad left thumb but playing well. Batting second, his father was a catcher in the major leagues, Mike Brumley, a switch hitter, hitting at .287. The designated hitter tonight is Doug Hodo, a .351 hitter, but no power, no home runs. In the cleanup spot, a man who's been carrying this ball club, Jose Tolentino, hitting .351, 12 home runs, 71 RBIs, team leaders in every category. Batting fifth, the veteran catcher, Jeff Heron, hitting at .342 this year. In sixth spot, out in right field, Darren Loy. He is a catcher by trade, but asked to play right field tonight. The exciting Johnny Sutton is in left field, a late bloomer this year, but hitting .400 at the moment. Batting eighth, Mike Trent. He has figured in both game-winning runs of the first two games of the College World Series for Texas. And in the number nine spot, Brian Burrow, the third baseman, under .282, but having a great 1983. And now let's set the defense for Alabama. That is David Magadan, the hitter at first base. Little Fern Lake is down at second base. The man from down under, Australia Shipley at shortstop. Elbin, the leadoff man that Jerry talked about, at third base. Out in left field, a man with power, and that is Rob Skates. In center field, the defensive ace of the outfield, Alan Stallings. And over in right field tonight will be Dee Smithy. Behind the plate, they say he's got the best arm around in this College World Series, Frank Valeggia. And on the mound, winner of 11 out of 13, Dean Hayes, who won a big, big game against Mississippi State at the end of the season to enable Alabama to continue on and get to where they are now, making their first appearance since the very first College World Series. The wind blowing again tonight, more toward left than last night when it was blowing toward center. 86 degrees, but a very low humidity. And the wind, as you can see, is 10 miles per hour. And they expect an outstanding crowd tonight. And why not? The battle of the unbeaten. Bill Bates with that bad left thumb, hitting .294, one home run, 33 RBIs. Big Dean Hayes starts him out with the fastball high and away. Bill Bethay will be coaching tonight at first base. And over third, Cliff Gustafson, he's the head coach. 83% of his games he's won in 16 years with Texas. That's ball two. Up high, ball three. We asked the pitcher, Hayes on the mound, which batter in the Texas lineup would give him the most trouble.
Well, the Texas hitters are all basically the same type of hitters, with the exception of one. They don't have a lot of power. They're contact hitters. I'm going to have to get ahead in the count, throw good low strikes, and make them hit the ball on the infield.
What Dean Hayes will try to do now is get this ball over at 3-0, and does. Who has stolen 16 bases. That's 343 down that line, 370 in the power alleys, 343 down the right field line, and 420 straight ahead. Outstanding stadium. I think we joined the Mike Easler, now in the major leagues, who played 12 years of minor league ball, said this is in his top three of all minor league stadiums in America, and it's a great place for the College World Series. In Omaha, on the banks of the Missouri River, Mike Brumley, switch hitter, hitting 287, but hitting very well lately. Meaning by that, nearly 380 in postseason play. Dale Williams, the crew chief, is behind home plate tonight. Joe Driscoll is at first base. Nick Runchy at second. And over third, Randy Crystal, who called balls and strikes in our game that Jared and I did last night. One ball, one strike. Pitches thrown by Hayes thus far, four of them well out of the strike zone. That's a strike. One ball, one strike. Jim, understandable. Go ahead, Jerry.
Excuse me. Coach Gustafson is very, very likely to have his hitters take a good deal of the time. When the count goes to 2-0, 3-1, chances are they'll be taking. In this case, the pitcher had walked the first man, and Brumley is
They got him, and they threw the ball away. Hayes threw it away with nobody to back up, and Bates will go on to third. They had Bates dead to rights. One problem. They didn't get the ball to the first baseman, Magadan.
This is a very, very damaging start for the Alabama defense and pitcher Dean Hayes. Bates was going on this pitch. He'd already started, and Hayes picked that up, but overthrew first base, threw widely, and Bates goes clearly and cleanly over to third base. I think possibly the sun had a problem here, or presented a problem to the first baseman, Magadan. It is tough for that side of the infield to look in into the setting sun over there in the west.
Maybe true, sir, but that throw was not an outstanding throw.
That's right, Jim. You're absolutely right. It was wide, and sun or no, it was tough for Magadan to get his glove on.
A break for Hayes there, so back to second goes Bates. By the way, Bates is down at second base because the ball got in among the tarp and they ruled that he had to go back to second. He was standing on third.
The ground rule came into effect there. If the ball had hit off the tarp and remained free and clean, then Bates could have gone as far as his progress would allow him, but he was forced back to second because the ball became dead when it hung up in the tarp.
Doug Hodo, the designated hitter, hitting 351. But the designated hitters for Texas in this College World Series are not doing that well. They're 1-for-8. By the way, to go back to Dean Hayes, because he did throw some bad pitches, he did have a throwing error. That throw to Brumley, that pitch which was up high that Brumley bunted, perfect because he popped it high since the ball was held high, and he helped himself there. 2-0. Michigan, regardless of who wins tonight. Alabama will play Arizona State, regardless of who wins tonight. But one team will play tomorrow night's games with its first loss of the year. Right back the middle, off the foot, and they're going to make no play there. Well, they haven't gotten the ball out of the infield yet. But nevertheless, they've got problems. Alabama does.
hits his ball pretty hard up the middle and off the leg of Dean Hayes. A rather poor follow through there by Hayes. Otherwise, he might have been able to get his glove instead of his leg on the ball. Goes for a base hit.
All runners at the corners. With the infield, having Maggott and holding Hodo on at first base. And Elvin about even with the bag at third. The rest of the folks out there, meaning Shipley and Lake, are hoping double play ball from the hottest hitter on the Texas squad, Jose Tolentino. Inside, like a slider, Tolentino, as you take a look at the runners, Bates at third and Hodo over at first. Tolentino, 351 average, leads the club. 12 home runs, leads the club. 71 RBIs, leads the club.
Likely Hodo will steal in this position now, in this situation with one out and their most productive hitter up at the plate. They'd love to see Tolentino have a chance to swing the bat and drive that run in from third.
He has swung the bat straight away center field where Stallings is, and here comes the run on home, and Texas leads. The walk, the error, and the infield hit. And now the sacrifice line drive by Tolentino. 72nd RBI. And that ties the record of Keith Moreland.
Batting fifth.
Back about 9 years ago at Texas. 72 RBIs. Now remember, depending upon what Heron does, and the run is on the scoreboard to stay, if Heron goes down, that's an unearned run, but it's the pitcher's fault because he's the man that threw the ball away. Dale Williams asking one of the bat boys to get the catcher's gear out of the on-deck circle where Heron had left it before stepping in. Heron hitting 342. Auto at first, two out, one run in. And now Heron wants a different bat. Big controversy with Jerry Kendall in the middle of our discussion in the car coming out here tonight. Some conferences would love to have the wooden bat back in college baseball instead of the metal bat.
Well, our conference is one of them, the Pac-10 Southern Division, and the move to reestablish the wooden bat is led by Rod Dado, the veteran coach at USC.
Here comes Jeff Heron, a catcher. Let's go down to our catcher, Jim Price.
Thank you, Jim. You know, what we're seeing here is what they see in Texas for many, many years. It's called gust ball. They get these little scat backs on base. They get an error. Somebody gets a walk. They get a base hit. That's how they've been doing it in Texas for a long time, Jim.
One ball, one strike, and he went around. One and two. Gustafson, by far and away the most successful coach. And you know, at Southwest Antonio High School, the final year before going to Texas, his team, high school team, won 39 ball games and never lost once. Not once. Ahead of Heron, 0-1. Dean Hayes and the check at first base. Cliff Gustafson, from what we hear, got very little sleep last night. Does he start LeBay? Or does he start Schiraldi, who is ready and is ace pitcher? And he's going with LeBay. Ground ball, and they'll flip it over to second base for the forced play. And one unearned run on one infield hit and a sacrifice fly. Now let's check in with the starting lineup of the Crimson Tide of Alabama. The last time the Crimson Tide of Alabama was in the College World Series, 33 years ago. This is only their second appearance. Brett Elbin, a switch hitter, will lead off and play third base. Leads the club in runs scored and in walks. Batting second tonight will be the designated hitter, Ted McClendon, a 376 hitter, an MVP in the Southern Regionals. Batting third is the man we talk about, David Maggonen, hitting 539, 94 RBIs. The cleanup batter is in left field, Rob Skates, a power hitter, a 348 hitter with 10 home runs. Batting fifth and known for his defense, out in center field, Alan Stallings, 6-for-8 in the College World Series thus far. The catcher, the best arm in the College World Series from behind the plate, Frank Bellegia, who has 11 home runs to lead the club. And there's little Furman Lake, the second baseman. He is 5 feet, 3 inches tall, but he can play the game. Batting eighth and in right field, D. Smithy. And at shortstop is another switch hitter, Craig Shipley, hitting 323. He is from Australia. Defensively, Tolentino, who drove in the run, will be at first base. Down at second base, the man who scored the run, Bill Bates. At shortstop, Mike Brumley. At third base, Ryan Burroughs. And out in left field, Johnny Sutton. More about him later on. Another good defensive outfielder, Mike Trent, in center field. And Loy, and they're concerned about his defense in right field. He's a backup catcher. The catcher is Heron, and the pitcher is Steve LeBay, who shut out Mississippi State, as we said. Not Steve LeBay to shut out Mississippi State. Steve LeBay, who would rather play right field than pitch. But here he is with rather good statistics, and he's got to pitch. He is 7-2 on the year. And all of this was brought about, this problem that they're having with an injury to their outfielder, David Denny, an elbow problem that has caused all of this juggling. Gustafson was a lot stronger in the outfield before that injury. Dick Wiggins will be the coach at first base tonight. And over at third base, Roger Smith. And the first batter will be Brett Elbin. Set a school record with 65 walks. He leads the club with 86 runs scored and hitting 345. And you know what he's up there to do, what all leadoff men are up there to do. But especially when you're down 1-0, get on base and get the tied in this ballgame.
Elbin is perhaps the most effective leadoff man in the tournament, Jim. He's hitting 345, and with those 65 walks, that's doing a job.
There's a strike in the tournament. Brett is 6-4-11. And his on-base percentage for the year is about 65% of the time.
What a blessing for an offense to have that kind of leadoff man.
Outside, 2-1. For those of you who don't follow Texas baseball but follow the College World Series, this is hardly any semblance at all of the Longhorn team that Gustafson had here last year.
There's only one player in the same position as last year. That's Jeff Heron. Mike Brumley has moved from center to short.
Ball four! Ball four, and Elbin does what comes naturally for him, his 66th walk of this year, and the tying run is on at first. There is Schottenberger. He is a PhD, and he is an outstanding coach of this Alabama team with 41 wins last year. He broke the all-time record for the Crimson Tide, and then he came back this year and won 45 ball games to further up that record. Ted McGlendon hitting 376. He was the most valuable player in the Southern Regional Tournament. Outside, and as Hayes started with a little difficulty finding the plate, so does LeBay start the same way. And remember, for Hayes to walk that first man cost him a run. Let's see what happens to LeBay.
Statistics bear out, Jim, that when you walk that first man of the inning, he generally will score. It's a no-no for a pitcher.
Line drive, right field, that's a base hit. Elbin on his way around second, but then thinks better of it, and McGlendon has picked up the first base hit of the night for Alabama. Men at first and second. Now here's Mr. Magadan.
David Magadan
hitting 539. The crowd knows who he is. 94 RBIs and 8 straight. And you think that's a fluke in the College World Series? In the Southeastern Conference, he went 10-11. No fluke. I'd like to get Jerry's opinion as throughout the evening we watch Magadan and watch this stance. You
You'll see that it's an unusual stance, but a very effective one.
Not quite Stan the Man. Strike on the outside corner. We asked LeBay, what in the world are you going to do against Maganin tonight?
I've watched him hit in both games, and he looks pretty like an all-around hitter. I'm going to have to try to keep the ball probably away from him and find a weakness early if I can.
Right on the outside corner, looked good for a strike. Tries the same thing, misses this time. One ball, one strike. The whole approach to this game centers around the man in the batter's box there and the man on the mound, LeBay, the only left-handed pitcher they've got with experience, and Gustafson has decided to go with it. Fouled away. One ball, two strikes.
One of the factors that caused Coach Gustafson from Texas to start LeBay rather than his right-hander, Schiraldi, was perhaps we can deal with Maganin, the left-handed hitter, a little more effectively with LeBay on the mound.
However, if Steve runs into trouble, Cliff Gustafson will quickly go to Schiraldi. Hit off the fist, Herb Brown.
That's exactly what he does not like. When he's in trouble, talking about Maganin, it's the ball on the fist. The left-handers that have really given him problems this year, surprisingly, David said it's not the curveball low and away, it's the fastball on the fist.
One ball, two strikes. Maganin, a second-round draft choice in the draft this year. 1-0 Texas, bottom of the first, but Alabama has none out. Elvin at second, McClendon on at first, and there's another foul off to the left and out of play. This crowd may be the largest thus far. Remember, they're way ahead of all-time College World Series attendance when they set the record in 1981. After six sessions, they have 70,524. After the sixth session last night, 73,683. Elvin at second, McClendon at first. And the count 1-2 to Maganin. And this may be two. Bumbley, Bates, Tolentino, and Maganin grounds into a double play. And over to third base goes Elvin.
This double play is made to order because Maganin, for all his hitting ability, does not run real fast. And so you can see that he's nicked there at first base by quite a margin.
Well, as you take a look at Elvin at third base and Rob Skates, another left-hander who's got power at 10 home runs this year, steps in against Maganin. The gamble, whoops, they've got it. The gamble to start LeBay worked at least in the first inning. With men at first and second and none out, bothered by that inside pitch on the fist, Maganin grounds weakly into a double play. There's the crowd we're talking about in this 86-degree temperature. Thunder showers are expected north of Omaha, but not in this city. As a public address announcer said, it wouldn't dare rain on the College World Series. I'm going to third, but one out, whoops, way inside, 2-0. Friday night, a doubleheader live here on ESPN. Alabama will play Arizona State. Texas will play Michigan. There's a strike. That's a good-looking pitch he throws to left-handers there on the outside of that plate. Breaking ball. Not one has been able to handle it yet. Two balls, one strike. Another breaking ball. Foul. It's 2-2.
I wonder if Coach Barry Schoenberger was tempted to separate his two left-handed hitters in the lineup against LeBay, the left-handed pitcher. But those two guys, Maganin and Skates, have been so productive in the third and fourth slots. I'm sure he didn't think of that very long, but here he is now facing two left-handers in a row.
Wow. Well, with all those great pitches and then busted him with the fastball. No runs, one hit, no errors, a man left at third base. At the end of one, it's Texas with a one-run lead. Championship has been decided. It's back to the USFL football live on ESPN. The Denver Gold and Oakland Invaders in a Pacific Division contest. Both are still in the running. 9 o'clock Eastern time, and Paul McGuire and I will be there. We are now, however, in Omaha, Nebraska, and here is Darren Loy. He is the defensive liability out in right field, and he and the Texas team and officials are the first to admit it, but he can swing the bat, hitting 321. Facing Dean Hayes.
Come on, Dean, fire!
You will see a little black patch on all Alabama players tonight on the sleeves, and I will tell you why. You can probably guess part of the reason. One of the reasons, dedication to the late Paul Bear Bryant, who was the athletic director as well as fine football coach. And then Roger Smith, a student assistant, age 20, suddenly died just several weeks ago, and they're putting together a four-year scholarship in his name. That ball is foul. And thus, in sorrow and sympathy for the family, the Alabama Crimson Tide uniforms carry the black patch. Now there's one ball, two strikes to Darren Loy. I'm sitting up here, you know, when you watch a ball game, how many times have you said, how could he take that pitch with two strikes? But he did, and he got away with it.
It was close. Too close.
2-2. That's way outside. 3-2. But that's a demonstration right there of the Texas philosophy of doing a lot of taking.
Yes, sir. They want to make sure that pitcher has plenty of work to do before they go to first base.
Oh. That's all. Loy strikes out. That's the first strikeout for Dean Hayes, who has given up an infield hit off his foot and a walk.
Number five.
An error.
Johnny Sutton.
Johnny Sutton is coming up. And Johnny, we asked before the game, tell us about your namesake.
Well, my name's Johnny Keene Sutton. And some of you may know my grandfather's name was Johnny Keene. He was the manager for the world champion Cardinals in 1964. And he also managed the Yankees in 65. Through him, when I was a little kid, I was able to know a lot of professional ball players like Mickey Mantle, Joe DiMaggio, Joe Pepitone. It was an exciting time for me. I was able to meet a lot of ball players when I was a little kid, and it was really fun.
Shipley on the second hop goes out the grandson of Johnny Keene. What a nice gentleman, Johnny Keene.
Number eight.
I remember him also. He was managing in the big leagues when I was playing. And I can recall, and it just occurred to me now, came back into my consciousness, that he used to speak about his grandson down in Texas. He had great pride, great fondness for his family, and he mentioned his grandson in a newspaper article that I read. There's the young man who just grounded out.
Mike
one.
Trent steps in, hitting at 298, and one more thing about Johnny Keene. Look it up. He is one of the most successful managers ever to get fired at the time he was fired. He wins practically the whole shooting match, and they say, that's enough, you didn't win at all. What an injustice to a fine, fine gentleman and manager. 1-0 Texas, top of the second. Strike one to Mike Trent. Base is empty. Slow grounder, leg, and makes a play on it. Hey, almost forgot something. He's charged by, but he stopped back to get it and picks it up. No runs, hits, or errors, and none left. We go to the last of the second. The Longhorns lead the Crimson Tide 1-0. Not as ominous as they may look, I hope, because they said all of those thunderstorms are to pass north of the city. Alan Stallings, the first man up. The base, Steve LeBay, as we begin the last of the second inning. Stallings, a 298 hitter, 6-for-8 in this College World Series, way outside. Nothing comes easy to this Alabama club, and we ask, Alan, how come you're so successful?
I think this team here, before every game, we just seem to be, you know, loose and not so uptight. And no matter we're playing the number one team tonight in the country, we seem to be calm and, you know, ready to go out and play ball. And I think that's been a real big success to us, you know, just being loose, and it's helped us a lot.
1-1 the count, and that's a ground ball toward the third baseman and pass Burrows into left field. And Stallings, for the second time, gives the Crimson Tide the leadoff man a tying run on base. And that'll bring up Frank Bellagio, who leads the club in home runs with the 11. Bellagio, 46 RBIs. LaBey, I have another comment about Steve in a moment. Fouled off. I started to say how he beat Mississippi State, and then I stopped in midstream. Well, he did in the Central Regionals, and after he shut him out 7-0, he said, I'd rather be out in right field.
Well, most pitchers are like that. They would much rather swing the bat than pitch. This young man can do them both.
Ground ball foul at the plate. Bellagio out of Baltimore, Maryland. 2-for-9, as you can see in the College World Series. With that big, powerful arm, and maybe we'll get a chance to see it tonight. He has gunned down 8 runners thus far this year. Stallings not making a move off first base. Let's call in Irv again.
Jerry, Eddie Stanky always said, bunch your infield. Play everything toward the middle of the diamond. You go along with that?
Generally, most of the balls are going to be hit up the middle rather than to the lines, and percentage-wise, that's a good move.
Took something off that and got it. And gets Bellagio looking on a change.
This is a tough pitch. I don't believe Bellagio was looking for a changeup in this particular situation, and he wanted to swing, changed his mind, thought better of it, and tried to swing, but it was too late.
One of the most embarrassing moments for a batter. You see it, it's there for you to hit, you got plenty of time, and all of a sudden this pass hit, you didn't do it. Furman Lake hitting 293. Stallings, who has stolen 6 bases this year, made no move at all to go or even take a big lead with Bellagio, the slugger at the plate. Let's see how he plays with little Furman Lake at the plate. And LaBey just threw that by Lake. Texas leads by 1 when the last of the second. Each team undefeated. Takes 2 defeats to put you out of the tournament. They could beat again, you know. If they, one will lose tonight, but they both win again tomorrow night, then you got the championship game Saturday night with the same 2 teams, and they haven't played each other, Alabama and Texas, in more than 60 years. What a time to get your rematch. That short right field, out goes Bates, in comes Loy, and it's going to be tough, and Loy takes it. And Loy keeps on and running the ball in. I don't know whether he just didn't want to throw it in and maybe get it away from somebody, or maybe he thought that was out number 3, but he kept running on him.
This was LeBay's pitch. He put this pitch on the outside part of the plate, and you saw that Furman Lake had to reach for it. He did not have a good swing. He was out in front of the ball. He had only one hand, the left hand on the bat when he made contact. Steve LeBay had Lake fooled with that pitch. It looked like be a changeup or possibly a slow curve. Very, very effective.
LeBay's done a good job. First 2 men got on in the first, and he got out of that with a double play and a strikeout. Leadoff batter single to get on first here in the second. He struck a man out and had Lake looking awful on that last swing. So LeBay has done the good job, but then again, that's what the Texas pitchers are supposed to do. That's how Texas wins all these games. Dee Smithy, a 267 hitter. The right fielder. There goes the runner, and here's the arm of Heron, and it's beaten. A stolen base for Stallings, who is now 7-for-9 on the year. Good jump.
Actually, Stallings took off on LeBay's first move. It didn't give Heron much of a chance to get the base runner, because at that very moment that LeBay began his move, it could have been a pickoff, in which case Stallings would have guessed wrong. But he did go to the plate, and Stallings got a huge jump. You can't blame the catcher for that stolen base.
Now, Smithy's got a chance to tie the game up with two out. And this is toward the shortstop, Bumley, who can handle those things, even though he's kind of rocky against Oklahoma State, and does handle it. No run, one hit, no errors, and Stallings left running on the base pads toward third base. They've gone through two complete now, and the unearned run of Texas holds up. They lead 1-0. Number 9 hitter leading off to start the third. Takes a strike. He's quite a story, something that probably goes by a lot of folks. 1982, Brian was struggling, hitting 194, I believe it was. Look at his average this year, 294. 100 points difference between 1982 and 83. Worked very hard.
He's one of those many examples that we see in this tournament. Don't give up. Hang in there, son.
One ball, two strikes. Dean Hayes, 11-game winner, has only himself to blame for what happened here, the one run, the walk, and the throwing error on a pickoff attempt, in which, by the way, he had his man dead to rights, but threw it away. Strikeout number 2, both of the swinging variety. The other victim was Loy to start the second.
Dean Hayes has a very correct and solid mechanical approach to pitching. He breaks at just the right time. There's where he breaks his hands over that lead knee, strides out long, left foot pointed straight toward the target, comes over the top, and throws a good pitch to retire Brian Burroughs.
Bill Bates takes a strike with a fastball. He's the man who started all the problems for Hayes, drawing the walk, going to second on the throwing error. Over to third on down out of play. An infield hit off the leg of Hayes by Hodo and scoring on Tolentino's sacrifice line drive to center field. That's the only run in this ballgame. One ball, two strikes. Upstairs, unlike last night's games between Arizona State and Oklahoma State and Michigan and Stanford, the loser does not go home. The loser still has a shot at winning this College World Series, but the winner, of course, would be 3-0 and would have two chances to win just one more. Whoops! That is deep. Stallings goes back. Smithy goes back. Watching the ball bound away from Stallings. On the way to third base is the speedy Bates. Stallings picks up the ball and throws to the cutoff man. Well, a matter of fact, he gets by the cutoff man and is picked up by the pitcher. But that's a solid triple all the way with Hayes out in front of the batter, 1-2, and he laced one.
This little fella, Billy Bates, is only a freshman, and he shows surprising power. He really gets into this, gets the arms extended. It was a low pitch, and apparently that's the one he hits the best, because normally he wouldn't show that kind of long ball power, and he surely fooled the Alabama outfielders. They were playing him shallow. It was well over their heads.
That'll bring up Mike Brumley. And Brumley tried to bunt his way on, and Hayes gave him a pitch high in the strike zone, and Mike popped it up. 1-0 Texas, a second run perched at third base. And the same man has caused Hayes problems both times. He was ahead of the count, 1-2, got the ball down. And this fella here, Bates, just really pumped it about 385 feet away. And that's going to make it 2-0 as Brumley drives in a run. That's the first earned run of the night. Two base hits in a row, a total of three given up by Hayes. No movement at all in the Alabama bullpen as of this moment.
Brumley just reaches out and gets this outside pitch and hits it hard. He wasn't about to let Bates rest at third base. He wanted to drive him in. And he got a pitch he liked away from him, slapped it to left field. Now he's on first. Watch him be ready to steal too, Jim. This Brumley is leading the team in steals with 30 stolen bases and 40 attempts. Loves to run. We may see Valeggia display his arm here against Brumley.
Hey, wow, almost got him, and Magadan thought he might have had him. will serve notice to Mike that he better stay close over there.
This Hayes has an excellent move, apparently. Remember, he picked off Bill Bates in the first inning, threw it wildly, but he had him dead to rights, and he just about had Brumley on that replay. Or as we saw on the replay, he almost had him on the original.
Odo with that infield hit back in the first inning. Ground ball, and this may squib foul, and does. Well, this is the kind of thing. Now, we know that Alabama scores runs in bunches and has a lot of power, but this is the kind of thing that Texas does time and again. They get a run here and a run there, and all of a sudden you realize you're not getting any runs because their pitching is so good.
Here's the replay on the bouncer down the first base line. He had his left foot on the line, which is fair territory. I wondered about that. That could have been a fair ball. The ball, when it hit the ground the last time before contact with the glove, hit in fair territory.
You know that Brumley did not have a big lead there because he didn't have to dive back. He just took a couple of steps and got back. Stretching it out a little bit more over there now, so they'll check him again.
As we watch Brumley take his lead, a good lead, a threatening lead off of a right-handed pitcher is about 15 or 15 and a half feet with your right foot on that mark, the base runner's right foot. And it appears Brumley is out at least that far. Maybe he's 16 feet out. He's looking for the chance to run.
Looks like he's going. He is going, and he can't get the ball. Leggia just dropped the ball. Went to pull it out of the glove, and whoops, there it went. That's a stolen base. And that's number 31 for Mike Brumley.
Jim Price, earlier in the game, called this Gus ball, and that's exactly what it is. Get those fellas on base that can scoot, can run, and Gus is going to send him. There goes Brumley. Easy steal of second.
Inside, and two balls, one strike to the batter, Doug Hodo, the designated hitter. 2-0 Texas, and Brumley in scoring position with one out in the top of the third. Ground ball, and this will be Lake to pick it up, and Hayes to cover as Brumley rounds third and then trots back. Third, and now I'm going to ask you something after this replay.
The first baseman's responsibility in any ball hit to his right is try to get it. Get over there and try to make the play. Remember, the pitcher's coming over to take your job of covering first base, and Hayes covered for him beautifully. Lake made the good play, and Hayes was there to cover.
I know that Tolentino is the best hitter they got, so this is just a rhetorical question, but I just wonder, with a guy like Brumley at third and two out, whether or not he might not be thinking of something. Popped him up instead. And Lake says, I've got it. And he better have it because Brumley's already across the plate. Naturally, one run, another Texas run. Gus ball, two hits, no errors, and Brumley left at third. To the last of the third we go. Texas 2, Alabama nothing.
We've got Jim Kaplan, 13 years with Sports Illustrated, been covering the pros. Boy, with the aluminum bat, we saw what Bates' ball does. The ball just jumps off the bat.
It's amazing. I'm just glad they don't have it in the major league. Some of them get killed.
What about the atmosphere here, Jim, compared to the pros?
Well, it's much folksier. You notice that right away. The announcer asked everybody to turn to the left and turn to the right and shake everyone's hands. And very pleasant. I don't find it hokey at all. It's very refreshing after what I'm used to.
Thank you, Jim. Got a little change in the weather down here, Jim Simpson.
I hope you brought your raincoat. Your umbrella may not stay up in that wind, Irv, you and Jim Price. Because as the public address announcer said, it wouldn't dare rain on the World Series of College Baseball, and maybe it wouldn't, but it sure is coming close. Stepping in is Craig Shipley, the shortstop. And he launched one to right field. Loy was playing deep and was coming on and makes the catch. A little ice cream cone there, but he holds on to the ball.
Was well hit, of course, and Darren Loy, he's taken a few criticisms out there for his lack of fielding ability. Remember, he's a backup catcher, but he does make the play just barely. On that replay, we see that he barely controlled the ball, finally secured it in the web of his glove.
Fred Elvin walked to lead off the first, but he died on base as Texas leads 2-0. They keep chipping away, and Alabama hasn't gotten too close. Slider for strike one. I never had a chance to say about Craig Shipley that he's from Australia. I've heard of tennis players from South Africa going to Texas and basketball players from Africa going to Houston, Texas. I've never heard of baseball players from Australia coming to the United States and going to Texas. And I know that Olajuwon went to Houston, Texas, not the university. 0-2 on two breaking balls to Elvin. Now comes back with a fastball, and on comes Trent. He's got the speed and gets there. Two well-hit balls, one by Shipley, one by Elvin, both flagged down by the outfielders. And here comes Ted McClendon, who singled to right field in the first inning, later erased on a double play. I tell you one thing, unless my eyes deceive me, over against those hills over there, it is raining.
Oh, yes. Behind this and to the right, Jim, we just barely see past the corner of the press box. It's raining just about a mile away.
Down low, let's go to Jim Price.
You mentioned last inning about the fine job that LeMay is doing. I'll tell you why he's doing a very good job. He's keeping the ball down, and he's changing speeds, using that changeup very well.
Ground ball foul off the fists, and it's one ball, one strike. Longhorn's got an unearned run in the first on a walk and an infield hit, a sacrifice fly. Picked up a run that is earned, their second run of the ball game in the top of this inning on a triple by Bates and a single by Brumley. Fouled out of play. Alabama has had three base runners, and they've had some balls well hit in this inning by Shipley and Elvin, but they're down 2-0.
What happened, Jim? Burroughs did not take charge of that ball. He took a step to his left and should have kept coming in and taking the ball on the previous hop, but he backed up and had to battle a tougher hop, and it finally got to him, and it went off his glove for an error.
Boy, you'd sure love to have a third out and have Magadan start off an inning, but instead you got a man on with two out, and here's Magadan, who grounded into a double play. And let's watch again. Remember, Steve LeBay worked him inside on the fists, and that's how he got him in the first inning. And I'm sure he'll go back to the same kind of situation against this great college hitter. Got that ball out over the plate.
It was a fastball, and LeBay better be pretty careful with that brisk wind, and he's really picked up here in the last inning. With that brisk wind blowing to dead left field, Magadan certainly has the power to take that fastball away from him and pump it over the left field fence.
If it gets up, it's gone.
I think so.
McLennan, not a base stealer, doesn't want to take the bat out of the hand of Magadan. Oh, breaking ball. Misses low. One ball, one strike. Contrast for the Crimson Tide the other night. They scored six quick wins against Michigan and then held on to win 6-5. In their first game against Arizona State, they won 6-5 in extra innings. Way inside with the fastball, 2-1. I hope it doesn't rain, because there are an awful lot of people here who support this College World Series, and only a few of them are undercover.
That's right. I think the crowd will approach 15,000 tonight, providing the weather holds.
Doubleheader live Friday night, remember. Ground ball toward Olentino, who says, "My friends, this belongs to me." And again, on an inside pitch, LeBay gets Magadan. And again, with men on base, the Crimson Tide go away empty. At the end of three, the Longhorns of Texas lead the Crimson Tide 2-0. Tonight, and who loses? Michigan will play Texas, and in the other game, Alabama will play Arizona State. The key to this is the loser tonight will play its game at 5:10 Central Time, and the winner of this game will play their game at 8:10. And the clouds begin to roll in. And Joe Boyle of ESPN is the only man that's not working tonight, as you take a look at Jeff Heron. But Joe will be back for tomorrow night's games, and we'll join Jim Price and Herb Brown and Jerry Kindall and myself, Jim Simpson, who are working this game. We got the old overkill going tonight, four men doing one game. And I can hear mutterings from Price and Brown saying, yes, and you two are undercover, and we're sitting out here.
Oh, I hope for their sake that the rain holds off, along with about 15,000 other people who want to see this ball game, along with you and I and all the viewers.
One ball, one strike to Heron, leadoff man, fourth inning, Loy and Sutton to follow. Ball, right field. In comes Smithy, says, I've got this one. And there's one out in the fourth. Let's go to Herb Brown.
Well, I guess we better work a little bit since you're telling us how easy it is down here, Jim. But, you know, Jim Kaplan from Sports Illustrated has been sitting with me a while talking about Dave Steven. He won his ninth last night, winning his pitcher in the big leagues. And, Jerry, you'll appreciate this. Remember when he was an outfielder for Itchy Jones in Southern Illinois? They put him on the mound one day, and everything he threw moved. And he's got as good a slider as I've seen.
Dean Hayes, the pitcher, throws a strike to Darren Loy, who has struck out swinging but did a good job on a line drive in short right field defensively an inning ago. Uh-oh, high, but Smithy says that's not that deep, so I'll take it for out number two. Ball jumped but got high, and that'll bring up Johnny Sutton, who grounded the short in the second. Two out in the fourth for Texas. They lead 2-0. The winner's bracket. Neither of these teams has yet lost in the College World Series. It takes two losses to get you out of here. Four teams are gone. Oklahoma State is gone. Stanford is gone. Maine is gone. And James Madison gone. That breaking ball caught the outside corner. The two teams who remain with one loss, of course, Arizona State and Michigan, who played last night against each other, who will play these two teams tomorrow night. Well, Hayes looks like a pretty smart pitcher. He's mixing them up.
Outside of that first inning where he victimized himself with the walk and the throwing error, he's been pretty effective. Of course, the other lapse was when he threw up the long ball to the to Bates, the triple.
Lake is just too short at 5-3 to haul that down. And Sutton picks up the fourth hit off Dean Hayes.
Johnny Sutton, Texas left fielder, delivers one of these patented line drives to the outfield that he has done so well in regional and national play. Furman Lake, only 5'3", got up as high as a six-footer on that particular jump. He really skied, but it wasn't quite high enough.
I think Kindall would have gotten it. Kindall would have gotten it.
Well, I wonder. He sure gave it a good effort.
Mike Trent rounded out to end the second inning. In those winning runs in the first couple of games. Of course, all he had to do is score one run in the James Madison game. That was a blowout, 12-0. His big one that they remember was against Oklahoma State. Safe as Sutton dives back. He is 4-for-4 in stolen bases. By the way, yes, Texas afield has looked pretty good tonight, whereas the other night against Oklahoma State in a game they won in 11, they had four errors. Worst defensive performance they've had all year. Through that breaking ball.
One of the reasons, perhaps, they suffered that defensive lapse the other night and made four errors. Texas plays most of its games at its home field, obviously, which is artificial turf. And coming to this grass, natural turf, it's an adjustment for the infielders.
There you can go back to the subject of the metal bats again. Metal bats on artificial turf, wow. Those batting averages go up.
Sutton's looking for a chance to run here, I believe. He's out there about 15 feet, the same as Brumley was last inning when he stole. It's a good time to run. A left-handed hitter at the plate, Trent, and two outs.
He is not going, and the pitch is outside. Not a pitch out. One ball, one strike. Well, Mr. Public Address Announcer, I hope you're right, but gee, it looks ominous. Able to slide by just down the right field fence there. Keep on going. Hey, he got a long lead there.
Close.
you're talking about the number of feet to take the lead. Maury Wilkes used to say, when I had to dive back and just make it, I had the good lead. And I said, well, how do you know that? You're liable to get caught. But of course, it's a feel of what your body can do. Leaning on the wrong foot, so he's not going. That pitch is just off the plate. Two balls, one strike. Scoreboard reads 2 runs, 4 hits, 1 error for Texas. No runs, 2 hits, and a costly error by the pitcher of the mound, Dean Hayes, for Alabama.
Sutton is 4 for 4 on stolen bases. He hasn't tried many, but when he's tried, he's been 100% successful.
Not going, ground ball, and there's Magadan, and he steps on the bag, and Sutton just heads for the outfield. No runs, 1 hit, 2 errors, and 1 left. The last of the fourth we go. Alabama's threatened, but hasn't come close. Texas has got the 2-1 lead. And George Grant has a wonderful show on Monday nights at 7 o'clock Eastern Time, 4 o'clock Pacific Time. Takes you around the major leagues and tell you what's going on in baseball. Right now, what is going on in baseball in Omaha, the College World Series. There's the score. And there is rain nearby Rosenblatt Stadium. We hope it, I know what it is. Rain, rain, go away, come again another day, like after Saturday afternoon's championship game. Rob Skates struck out swinging with the man on base back in the first inning, up for the second time. Thus far, the gamble to start Steve LeBay. The left-hander has worked for Cliff Gustafson. Changed on that, and Skates was out in front. It's 1-1. During mid-inning, the wind kicked up so much, and I think that Heron has been hit, I believe, and they're checking with him. Wind has picked up so much that the wind was blowing up the third baseline hard.
This is the catcher. The catcher's fear. That is, there is no explanation.
Dust swirling about.
Fortunately, he's all right. Points up the toughness, the durability, courage of the catchers, right, Jim Price?
you better believe it.
Jim loves catchers. And it's raining. Fouled off. The rain has begun to come into Rosenblatt Stadium.
This is typical of United States. These storms blow in the Omaha area very, very quickly.
Ooh, that was over his head, 2-2. The wind is blowing not as hard as it was moments ago. It has actually slowed down, and it is still blowing hard. That thing was absolutely stiff just about 2 minutes ago. Foul tipped, hung on to by Heron, and Skate strikes out for the second time. The third strikeout for Steve LeBay. Out on the fourth, 2-0 Texas.
This pitch is up in the strike zone, but Skates can't afford to let it go by. It's too close to take with two strikes. He has a pretty good cut at it, but gets past it.
In the second inning, Alan Stalling singled and stole second base, and that's as far as he got. LeBay thus far given up no runs, of course. Two base hits, both of them solid hits, struck out 3 and has walked 1. One of the big differences in the ball game, the error by Alabama hurt. The error by Texas did not hurt. A lot of the folks are heading for underneath the stands. They won't go home, but with the rain and the threat of more rain, some of them are thinking, I better be smart about this thing. And so some of them are coming in now as though they've been told, you're chicken, you better come back. It's not really going to rain. Ground ball. For Brumley, long throw on one hop and got him. Nice play by Tolentino, who went down to make sure that ball didn't snap by him.
29. Brumley goes deep in the hole. Watch as he goes from the ready position with a crossover step, gets in front of the ball, fields it easily. Now he has time to throw, but he throws low and in the dirt. Jose Tolentino bails him out with a very good play. He wanted to block that ball. You're right, Jim. Many times the first baseman will stretch out and use only the glove to try to block it. He used his body.
The Legia sees the ball go down low. Frank, last time up, he was at, do I swing, do I not? Whoops, the change is by me, strike three call. Now out back, that's pretty, but that also spells raindrops. This one he picks on and sends high. Sutton goes back. Strikeout, a ground out on a short fly to left field. They've gone through four innings, and Texas in this winner's bracket game still leads by two. It's now on twice a week, Tuesdays and Thursdays. Don Marciano gathers together nationally known sports authorities, and they discuss the world of sports, all different phases of it, and all different sports. And Burrow will lead it off for Texas. We've already reached the fifth inning. One of the College World Series, Jerry Kendall has explained to me, since he's won a couple of championships here, you don't have any games called at the end of seven with someone winning saying, well, they've played a complete game. In the College World Series, a complete game is nine innings, period.
It's a good rule, Jim. The NCAA Baseball Committee has decided that they come this far and have played this hard.
Popped up to the right side. Smithy and Lake, and Smithy takes it.
There's eight teams that have qualified from around the country have come this far and have a chance to win the national championship. The NCAA Baseball Committee has decided we're going to give them every opportunity to do that. Every game will be nine innings. So if the rain comes, it will be a suspended game held up until it can be resumed.
Bill Bates, he's been the thorn in the side. He scored both the runs. Walked, went to second on an error. Later came in on an infield hit, or rather sacrifice fly. Then tripled and rode home on Brundley's single. Since the single by Brumley that scored Bates, Otto hit his ball to the right side. Tolentino popped up to the right side. Heron and Loy flied to right. Sutton lined a single to the right. Trent hit the ball out of the first baseman, and Burrow started out the fifth inning by hitting to right field. So everything's been going that way over the last two and a half innings. One ball, two strikes.
Bill Bates, remember, tripled the last time up. Pitch away from him, hit it well. Here's another look at Bill Bates's swing. Watch that back foot. See how he pivots up on the ball of that back foot to allow the hips to get out of the way, to whip out of the way, which then allows him to bring his hands, his arms through, and increases the bat speed.
Got a one and two.
Hitter. Excuse me, Jim.
Houston, Texas. Hometown. Had that bad left thumb, as we told you, but he's just going on playing with it and playing very well. Still one ball, two strikes. Texas by two. Winner of this will play the second game tomorrow night. Now that is 8:10 Central Time, which is 6:10 on the West Coast and 9:10 on the East Coast. And those times are approximate because before that game, the loser of tonight's game plays the game at 5:10. And of course, it all depends on how quickly that game is over. First inning, but lashed a single on an outside pitch. He went with it to left field in the third inning and drove in a run. Inside, right there is Dr. Barry Schallenberger. Now it looks like Schallenberger, but the Alabama folks said, nope, everybody mispronounces it. It is Schallenberger. Whatever, he is a fine baseball coach. Done wonders at Alabama. 2-0 now to Brumley with two out in the fifth. When
last pitch to Brumley down in the strike zone. Very tough to hit. He did take a pretty good cut at it, but it was way out of strike zone down low.
3-1. They tell us that Council Bluffs is over to the right. When you look over there, you can't see it because there's rain surrounding it. And high in the air, right field, Smithy and Stallings going back. And Stallings is there and holds it in near the warning track. Long drive, deep right center field. And Hayes puts it down 1-2-3 for the only the second time in five innings. We go to the last of the fifth in this winner's bracket game of the College World Series. The Longhorns continue to lead by 2 over Alabama.
Michigan coach Bud Middall here. Bud, congratulations last night. A big win for you.
Thank you very much, Jim.
What do you think of this game so far tonight?
Well, it's a tight ball game. I think it's going to stay that way all the way to the end.
You have to play the Longhorns tomorrow night. What do you think about that?
Well, it's going to be a tough chore, but I think we're going to be ready for them.
Hey, guys, this is one of the finest college coaches in all of baseball. Now back upstairs.
You're right, Jim Price, and also I might add a couple of Michiganders get together down there. You wouldn't be rooting, would you, Jim? Herman Lake, who really had a bad swing for a short pop fly to right field last time up, gets a good swing this time and drills one to left field for the third base hit off Steve LeBay. And for the third time in five innings, the Crimson Tide, yet to score, have the leadoff batter on. And yes, Lake can fly. Not a consistent base stealer, but he's got 11 in 19 attempts. And let's see how they do with D. Smithy. And D. Smithy comes from Austin. Does it bother him to play against Texas?
Sure. I know Darren Gustafson and Coach Cliff Gustafson. They live pretty close to me. And, you know, it is kind of special, you know, playing some guys that you know. And since I'm from Austin, it'll mean a little bit more to me to beat him tonight.
Here's Smithy, a 267 hitter, grounded out in the second, playing against the school back in his old hometown. But he's playing for Alabama. Lake is not going foul at the plate.
Jim, I don't think Furman Lake will try to steal second base. They're down by 2 runs. The important run is at the plate. And with the wind blowing out to left field, D. Smithy having 4 home runs, he could loft one up into that wind and tie the game with one swing. So the presence there of Lake at first base is not really significant to trying to tie the game. Smithy is the important one.
Pitch out, but they were not agreeing with you. I agree with you, but they figured something might be up.
Coach Gustafson called a pitch out there, and Jeff Heron did, in fact, relay it to the pitcher. It was a pitch out, but I think with nobody out, it would be bad percentage for Lake to try to run.
They're still concerned about him. 1-1. Now, just having heard Bud Middall with Jim Price, he's the man that might run him in a situation like this, because Bud kind of does unorthodox things, and he's done them so well. He won the Big Ten championship, and he's still in this World Series. Hit off the fist down the right field line, curving toward the line, but it's going to drop in there fair. Lake will go on to third base, and the ball gets away.
Significant ball, or the significant run, and Lloyd allowed it to get past. Now he's at third base with nobody out, and he's only 90 feet away from tying this ball game.
And they've now given the error, so give a double, I would imagine. We haven't heard the official, and then an error to allow Smithy to get on to third. And for the first time, I see some lightning in the sky. And lightning is struck for Alabama. A single by Lake, a double by Smithy, an error by Loy in right field. And with Greg Shipley, who hit the ball sharply last time, up, they could tie it outside. Last time, he hit the first pitch, went to right field on a line drive that Loy hauled in. 2-1, Texas. Alabama threatening. Infield in. And this is going to tie it up, I think, as it drops in front of Trent. Here's the throw into second base. It's 2-all. Three straight base hits. And Steve LeBay has been touched up here in the fifth inning.
And by the tail end of the batting order.
Still none out. 2-all ball game, and Texas is getting somebody ready to go. And it is Calvin Schiraldi, their ace.
And the runner at third base, D. Smithy, as the ball left the infield, did retreat to third base in an attempt to tag up if the ball was caught by Trent, but it fell safely in front of him, and you saw him come home easily.
I'll repeat again. That Schiraldi, as we told you, has gone down to warm up. 2-all, none out, and Elman was walked and lined to center, the man up. And there's Schiraldi. The debate was whether to start him or LeBay tonight. They went with LeBay, and for four innings, it looked like a great choice, and still may have been a great choice. We'll wait to see what happens. Fastball, and there's another base hit. Loy goes out and falls down. The ball gets away from him. Now the throw to second. Nobody's at second base to cover till the last minute. He's safe. The shortstop firmly was up the line. Bates had gone out for the cutoff. And Elvin just steamed into second. There was no one for Loy to throw to at second base. And here comes Cliff Gustavson.
All right, here's the play now. Remember a moment ago, Loy in right field let a ball get past him for a damaging error. He wasn't going to let this one get by. He was going to get down in front of it and block it. But as he did, he slipped. And now that prevented, or allowed rather, Elbin, the hitter, to go to second base, where otherwise he would have held there at first base.
As we come back, you can see the wind on the jersey of LeBay. Dust is blowing across the infield. We've got runners at second and third. First base is open. McLendon is up, and that very dangerous Dave Magadan is still in there. And I would imagine that Gustavson has to be careful, but he would sure like to have a left-hander in there when Magadan comes up with men on base.
Yes, LeBay has pitched Magadan very, very effectively. He's retired him twice, weakly on a double play ball hit to the shortstop in the first inning, and then a bouncer to the first baseman in the third. So Gus is going to let him leave him in, excuse me, and let him pitch to McLendon and hope he can get him out, and then let him try it again with McLendon, or excuse me, with Magadan.
Pitch to McLendon. He is single and reached on an error. They have not given an error, so we have to give Elvin a double all the way. Despite the slip and fall by Loy out of right field. Infield in. Two all. Good breaking ball. A big cut. One ball, one strike. Nobody is out. Runners at second and third.
McLendon is trying to get the ball up in the strike zone where he can drive it into the air and score that run. He takes a bad swing at that low pitch. Should let that go.
That one gets away from Heron, but it's up the line and right in front of him. And so all the runners have to hold. The Texas, the Longhorns, number one in the country, were just cruising along behind LeBay until this, the fifth inning.
Jeff Heron keeps his body in front of that low pitch and does his job. Remember, it's not so important to catch that ball, that low pitch in the dirt. It is absolutely essential to block it. He did that and prevented the runners from advancing.
Base hit right back to the pitcher. He does not take the throw to third base. He throws out McLendon, and that's the old axiom, get me one, and he's the pitcher. He didn't want to take a chance. He wanted at least one out of that.
You're right, Jim. It would have been a close play at third base, and maybe he wouldn't have gotten that runner, and he wisely elected to fake the runner back to third. We'll see it here on the replay. Here's the runner now. He'll make a fake break toward home as he sees the ball is caught by the pitcher, LeBay. He dives back, and LeBay wisely goes to first base to get that all-important first out this inning.
LeBay has been able to handle Magadan tremendously. A weak double play. in the first inning, and Magadan grounded in two off the fists. Now they're going to put him on and bring up another left-hander in Skates. Then they handled him on an inside ball, but I guess Gustafson figures three times unlucky. Don't tempt him another time, because this man had eight straight hits. There is Rob Skates on deck. Second walk given up by LeBay. It loads them up. They can play a double play depth with one out, and they can go to work on yet another left-hander. Skates, who has struck out swinging both times against LeBay.
It's good percentage, as you pointed out, Jim. Magadan, being the outstanding hitter that he is, carrying a .539 batting average in here, you can't tempt fate three times in a row. And I think Gus has done wisely to order the intentional walk. Now pitch to Rob Skates, who he's retired on strikeouts the last two times.
There is Cliff Gustafson looking on. Now remember, he has walked Magadan. Good baseball to load the bases, set up the possibility for the double play, and Skates has been handled by LeBay, but Skates is the cleanup hitter. The cleanup hitter. So he is to be reckoned with. There's a strike. Now we have a scoring change. They have now decided it is an error the hit of Elbin, misplayed by Loy when he fell down. So change it to a single, and the second error of this inning by Loy in right field. One strike, and that ball is hit deep to left field. It may score the man from third base. Here he comes, and Alabama takes the lead 3-2. The other runners hold. Skates gets the job done. And I would imagine about as good as Gustafson could have hoped for, aside from an inning-ending double play.
Now, they're still very much in it. At this point, Texas has avoided the big inning that Alabama was threatening, and the intentional walk, I think, was probably a key there. Now, here's the replay. You see the runner at third base tagging, that's Shipley, and the fly ball to left field by Skates, and he comes home easily. In fact, the throw went to third base. There wasn't even attempted to throw.
Well, LeBay has done his job working to Magadan and Skates, the left-handers, but with Stallings due up, Schiraldi is coming in, I am sure. Galvin Schiraldi, the man they were going to start, is going to now come in. He is a number one draft pick. LeBay has worked 4 2/3 innings, responsible for the two men on base. He has given up 3 runs, 5 hits, struck out 3, and walked 2. And not all of this was his own doing. Remember, some balls have been misplayed out there in right field. And here comes Schiraldi. I'll give you his numbers in a moment. A reminder that there are 2 games tomorrow night. Alabama will play Arizona State in one. Texas will play Michigan in the other. The winner tonight will play the later game at about 9 o'clock Eastern time. It'll be Michigan and Texas. If Texas wins, that'll be the late game. Alabama and Arizona State, if Alabama wins, they will be the late game. The loser, of course, will play the early game. And they'll be live here on ESPN. Let's go to Herb Brown. Herb?
Yeah, Jim, you know, I was just going to mention Schiraldi out there getting loose. A year ago, unfortunately, he was the guy that hit Kevin Penner from Wichita State. It's one of the worst things I think any of us have ever seen. I thought the ball hit the bat. That wasn't the case at all. It was the ball breaking the bone in his face. But a happy ending. This year, Penner, with a protective type helmet, was able to lead Wichita State in hitting. So even though he got drilled and Schiraldi had a rugged time getting over to himself emotionally, things did end up extremely well for Penner. He played well. Schiraldi came back to become an All-American.
Schiraldi, as we told you, a number one draft pick this past week. And now let us take, whoops, everybody got a gulp as they saw some lightning there. Schiraldi's statistics are these. He's won 13 and lost 2. Ready for his earned run average, 1.74.
We can get a look. More. Excuse me, Jim. We can get a look here as we slow motion Schiraldi at why he's a first-round draft pick. He has tremendous power. Notice that back leg, how he bends the back leg and drives off the pitching rubber with that lower part of the body and throws tremendous energy and momentum into the arm as it whips through. He has about a 93-mile-an-hour fastball on his good days.
Elbin down at second base, Magadan at first base, and Schiraldi, they always like to have that, as a rule of thumb, 2-to-1 ratio strikeouts to walks. And Schiraldi struck out 106 and walked 51. Perfect. He's pitched more innings than anybody except Roger Clemens, 134 and two-thirds innings. Comes in now, remember, with two men out, and the runners you just saw, Elvin at second and Magnin at first, and Alabama up by a run with a three-run fifth inning.
Jerry and Jim, I've never seen an offensive hitting club like Alabama has. They remind me of the Milwaukee Brewers. How about you guys?
That's right. They have tremendous power and can break loose at any time, which we're seeing here in the fifth inning.
LeBay, who loves to play in right field, we will check to see whether or not he remains in as the DH or as the right fielder. We'll check that closely. I guess being taken out, he's got to stay in as a DH and cannot play on the field. Strictly the DH because of the fact that he's already appeared. That would be it. A Stallings is struck out by Girardi. A three-run score on four base hits. Those two errors by Loy out in right field and two men left. At the end of five, Texas, which had led by two, now trails by one. Alabama three, Texas two. Bunch of thunder, and Jim Price and Herb Brown are out in that. Here's LeBay, and I want to say something about this pitcher that just went out, now staying in as a designated hitter.
Batter, Steve LeBay, DH.
Ground ball foul, and that is that LeBay immediately declared the designated hitter upon being removed from the mound, technically did not leave the ball game. So technically he's still in the ball game as a DH, and now they would be able to move him into right field next time Texas takes the field.
That conceivably could happen, yes.
Could happen, and after Loy's two errors, it might very well happen. I want to tell you, the rain around here and in the Midwest, you get these thunder boomers like that. We didn't pencil that in. That's the real thing right there.
I'd hate to be holding an aluminum bat right now, frankly.
Oh, caught the inside corner, and LeBay strikes out. That is the third strikeout for Hayes, who now leads for the first time in this ball game by the score of 3-2.
Good pitch by Hayes. Hayes is showing a lot of composure on the mound today. He suffered. He went behind 2-0. He hung in there well. Now his teammates have given him the one-run lead. He got the all-important first man up in the inning following, resuming that lead.
Tolentino has driven in a run with a sacrifice fly and popped out to the right side. 0-1. He's their leading hitter. RBI man and home run man.
Here's one of the participating coaches, Jim Brock from Arizona State.
Got to play tomorrow night. Arizona State, not with the firepower they usually have when they come to the College World Series, but they're still in it. I would call this weather impressive. It is all around us as we look down the right field line and out back of the stadium, and we felt some raindrops, but it has not yet really affected the play here. Slightly raining, strong wind, and now when I said slightly raining, the rain begins to come into the booth. So let's change that to slight from slight.
Well, the grounds crew is mobilized over there by the first base dugout in the event that home plate umpire Dale Williams signals for the tarp to be covered, or take the tarp, cover the field. They're ready to go, and it could happen any moment.
The ball's two strikes. Ground ball, that lightning get much closer and they could call it.
That's a scary item.
So scary that in professional golf, as you well know, Jerry, once they see it, the siren goes off and clear that course. It's all around us. Dale Williams, the crew chief, is the umpire behind the plate. And the game, of course, is in his hands. That ball is hit to right field where Smithy goes over near the warning track and takes it for the second out. Tolentino now 0-2, and Jeff Heron, the catcher, 0-2 coming up.
Number 12, Jeff Heron, the catcher.
Three runs, six hits, one error for Alabama, two runs, four hits, and three errors, two of them costly in the fifth inning for Texas. And now the rain has really begun to come down. There may be no question here in a moment for Dale Williams.
Here it goes, Dale Williams.
And that's it. They're going to call time, and they race for the dugout. And it is really raining now. And we're going to go away as the tarp is coming out. And let's take a pause from Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha with Alabama leading 3-2 and go to Sports Center. Omaha, the rain has stopped for the moment. There's still rain in the area. Delay of about 15 minutes. I'm Jim Simpson with Jerry Kendall. They are two out in the Texas six. They're down 3-2. Alabama at bat. Let's quickly check in with Jim Price.
Hey, Jim, during this delay, I went down to Texas dugout, talked with some of the hitters. I said, what's this pitcher from Alabama throwing? Hayes. They said he's spotting his slider real good and throwing a cut fastball. He's been effective. On the other hand, I talked with pitcher Roger Clemens, you know, the ace starter. He said he will be available if the game is close the last couple of innings. Now over to Irv Brown. I think you have something.
Yeah, thank you, Jim. I went out and checked the home plate area, the mound. Neither are going to be a problem. You don't even need a popsicle stick to take the dirt off your spikes. The wettest area, probably around second base. You might see him run on the grass, those infielders. The one thing to look for, Jerry Kendall, the grass is wet. That means you can load the baseball up. Let's go back upstairs.
Who do you suppose would do that, or not in college baseball? Come now.
Dean Hayes, the pitcher, has two out, a count of one strike to Jeff Heron. He leads 3-2, and with this delay, Schottenberger has gone to Troy Brockley to go down to the Alabama bullpen just in case. He has set the school record with 12 saves. He's their short relief man. Alabama by one. With three runs on two errors in the fifth inning, and that's two strikes to Heron. That strong wind blowing toward left field has slowed down considerably. One ball, two strikes. There's the flag. Remember how it was standing out from that pole? And ever the optimist, Jerry Kindall said, well, that could mean that the rain clouds stay in the area. They're not going to be blown away. I just hope it's gone through, because you can now see Council Bluffs where before we could not.
It's broken up somewhat above us there.
Well, it's not a foul ball. That ball's going to drop in. A twisting ball off the bat at Heron, and a base hit number five off Dean Hayes. And the tying run is aboard. And the man up is Darren Loy. Now, Loy may or may not remain in the ballgame in right field, remember. Once this is over, he committed the two errors. He struck out in the second against Hayes and flied weakly to right in the fourth. College World Series, neither of these teams has lost a game, so the winner has a couple more games in which to win the championship.
Darren Loy went fishing for a bad pitch. It's way up in the strike zone there. And breaking away from him besides.
Inside again. And you would say that Heron is not going anywhere, despite the fact that two outs. He has tried to steal only once this year and didn't make it. Short lead. High to one. Brockley continues to throw. Schiraldi came on in relief of LeFay in the last inning. Now that's a pitching staff. When you can start on LeFay, come in with Schiraldi, he was a number one pick, and have ready for tomorrow night another number one pick in Clemens. Gustafson has got pitching down at Texas. 81% plus he has won at Texas. Second goes the tying run. And up Sutton, who last time out single over the glove of Lake.
75.
There's Buckley, 12 saves.
75 degrees now.
The school record.
Still throwing easy in the bullpen, Jim. Barry Schoellenberger is not too alarmed yet, it doesn't appear, at the condition of his starter, Dean Hayes. But remember, he had Darren Loy with one strike and then threw four straight balls to Walker.
Strike to Sutton, down on second base is Heron with that single down the right field line, and on at first base is Loy with that one strike count and then four straight pitches. How often it happens, a pitcher going well, they'll get a delay because of rain or something like that, or even a big inning by the offense comes out and it's a little while and sometimes doesn't get it all back. 1-1.
Six balls in a row, and Coach Schoellenberger perhaps now is becoming a little bit more alarmed. Darren Hayes is showing some signs of weakness or perhaps tiredness after that 20-minute rain delay. Dean Hayes.
One around. One and two, two out. Talking about the tarpaulin was bought here some years ago for the College World Series, and as a result, only once in the last 19 years that they've had that tarpaulin here have they finished late because of rain in the College World Series. You get the storms, but they cover the field and they blaze right on through. Right field, base hit. Heron doesn't have all the speed in the world. Smith is up for the ball and comes on to the cutoff man, and no play. Tie ball game. Sutton drives in Heron.
Same for Hayes, but I'll tell you, there's a problem besides that. He's got a cut on his pitching hand, on the finger. It happened early in the ball game. Caught a ground ball back to the mound. I can't remember the exact inning, but I took a look during the rain delay. It is a problem, and he may not finish. He does have some problems right now.
Now the go-ahead run is up at third base. Just after Alabama snatched the lead from 2-0 to 3-2, Texas has come back after the rain delay to tie it, but a chance now to go ahead. Trent is 0 for 2. Strike inside corner. Mike is grounded out twice to the right side.
Jim, I wouldn't be surprised if in this situation with two outs and then a first and third in a tie game, if Coach Cliff Gustafson doesn't put on a double steal attempt. He has two pretty good runners on, particularly Sutton at first base, and Darren Loy is, has pretty good speed also.
Has not been successful as a base stealer this year, however. Loy, and can't get away with that. Loy, close. At third is Loy, at first is Sutton.
Here's the ball that gets away from the catcher, Valencia. It's down low. It's definitely a pass ball if they advance. However, they didn't advance, and he recovers quickly, and Hayes gets into cover home plate in the event that Loy had tried to score.
One ball, one strike. Barkley throwing a little bit harder out in the bullpen for Alabama. Too low. There goes the steal. Down to second. They lose the ball. Picked up. Run scores. They're ahead. Texas has taken the lead, and now the tag. Double steal, Jerry Kimball called it perfectly as Loy comes in. And Sutton is out stealing. The inning is over, but 2-1 score on two base hits after the rain delay plus a walk.
This is a delay double steal. The runner at first, Sutton, broke as the ball hit the catcher's glove. The throw went through to second base, and as soon as that ball was released by the catcher, the runner from third broke home. Sutton was in the rundown.
Two runs, two hits, no errors, and none left. And now Texas bounces back on top with Schiraldi on the mound. They lead by one. To drop one more time. And looking out, I do believe, and I may be wrong, we'll put a look out there that LeBay has stayed in the ball game and gone to right field. I think that is LeBay out there, gentlemen, if you can get your cameras on him, and not Loy. Stepping in is Valeggia. And let us see. It is Ray, not LeBay. Okay. For defensive purposes, there's the right fielder. Bud Ray goes in. Loy is out.
It's a good move because now with the one-run lead, defense becomes all important.
Valeggia's not had a hit tonight and won't get one here. 0-for-3. Coming up, and we had a question about Herman saying you came to Alabama from Aruba. What's baseball like in Aruba?
Oh yeah, they got baseball, and they play pretty good baseball up down there. You know, surprised a lot of people. You know, it's just that the guys don't really have any scouts or anything like that that goes down there and scout the players from Aruba. So you know, it's not too well known right here in Alabama or say you know, United States. But they really got some good players in Aruba.
That hard to figure out. Herman, he singled and scored last time up. And that there's some folks from St. Thomas that have played very well. And there's a pretty good pinch hitter, designated hitter in baseball today by the name of Jose Morales, who's from St. Croix.
Here's an interesting contrast. At bat, Lake is just barely taller than Jeff Heron, the catcher, who's crouching down.
Giraldi, the pitcher, and he is tough. Alabama trails, and it's up to Schiraldi to protect. There are two men, however, in this Alabama lineup that are thrilled to see Schiraldi as good as he is in there, and their names are Magadan and Skates. They've been handcuffed by the left-hander LeBay, and now they get a right-hander to look at.
It sure is, and the mound is a little bit slippery. You can see Schiraldi now carving out the dirt that's stuck in his spikes. That'll happen after the moisture hits there.
Oh, well, Lake didn't think so, but Dale Williams says that breaking ball got the outside corner. 3-2. Some time ago, 13-2, a 1.74 earned run average. And there's a line drive toward Bates, who gloves it. Let's go to Jim Price.
Hey, Jim and Jerry, you know, there's quite an adjustment you have to make if you're an Alabama batter. Steve LeMay was a spot pitcher. He turned the ball over. I say he was throwing in the high 70s. Schiraldi, he gets timed up in the 90s and high 80s. A big adjustment for the Crimson Tide.
Dee Smithy, 1-for-2, a double and a score to run. Two out, sixth inning, and it's 4-3 Texas. He can really throw hard.
Well, I'm impressed with this young man's arm, Jim. It's probably, he and Jim Jefferson from Arizona State probably have the best velocity on their fastballs of any pitcher in the College World Series. They're in the 90s consistently.
Drive high in the air, not too deep. Sutton is there, should be the third out. And it is. And Schiraldi has retired all four men since coming into the ballgame with two out in the fifth inning. No runs, no hits, no errors. And none left. Alabama trails by one, and they got a big obstacle in their way. That big obstacle thing is Calvin Schiraldi. Back to Omaha in a moment. Friday night's live coverage, but Mona is on the rain that's falling in. Michigan will play Texas And in the other game, Alabama will play Arizona State. The winner of tonight's game will draw the second spot tomorrow night. You'll see both games live on ESPN. I wonder if this game will still be going on tomorrow night. Look at that ring. Here's the juggling act by the baseball maniac. Juggling helmets. The fans here are something. During the rain delay that hurt Dean Hayes, it didn't hurt the crowd. They stood around and with organ accompaniment sang, "Take Me Out to the Ball Game." Mike Trent was up at bat when the double steal occurred and the go-ahead run. Loy came home from third base. Well-executed double steal. They were after Sutton and got him in the rundown, but by that time, Loy was home with the go-ahead run. Now Trent tries to bunt his way off. Foul.
You can lay double steal, Jim, that Loy and Sutton executed as they at last inning and scored that go-ahead run. Can be utilized when there's a slow runner at third base. Slow or not as fast as perhaps Sutton was. Sutton was the decoy, got in the rundown, and that permitted Loy to coast home from third base with the go-ahead run.
Texas got those two runs after the rain delay a couple of years ago here in the World Series. They were playing Michigan. They were trailing 5-2, and they had a rain delay of about an hour and 45 minutes. And as soon as the rain delay was over, Texas came storming back in that game. Much of the crowd when the rain hit left, period. And they were watching an outstanding ball game. But I guess they just figured there was no place to go except for their cars to stay dry. Dean Hayes has gone all the way. One of the four runs scored against him, unearned, but it was of his own doing. Swing on either pitch.
No, he's trying to work his way on base now. I believe he'll be taking again.
Continues to fall. Here's Bates. Only the last time up did he do no damage to Alabama. Scored two runs. He is 1-for-2 officially. Ground ball toward Magadan, who's going to take it himself. It was over to third, goes Burrow. Bates is out. Two out. And Mike Brumley unsuccessfully, but singling a run, and then drove Stallings very deep to the warning track the last time up. The wind has switched around and may be bringing more rain back our way. The rain is still coming down, but instead of blowing from first toward third, it's now blowing from third out toward right field.
The Alabama infield defense has got to be alert to a possible bunt here by Mike Brumley. He's a very skillful bunter, very fast to foot, and if he lays that ball down in the wet grass, it would be tough to play it.
They're alert for it, and the ball gets off the glove of Valencia. Here's a play at home, and they got him. He's out. Burrow cut down on the ball that would be labeled a pass ball, but Valencia came up with it. Throw to the pitcher, Hayes covering, and the inning is over.
Here comes Burrow's attempting to score on the ball that got away from Frank Valencia, the catcher. He recovered very nicely, hustled to get the ball, and Hayes came in to cover home plate. And it was well executed after the ball conceivably could have added another run. Oh, he's out definitely. Yes, he slid right into the glove. Here he comes. We see a third look at it. The slide, the tag, and another run prevented. The score remains 4-3 in favor of Texas over Alabama.
you see Caddyshack?
I didn't.
Hope we're not in trouble with this thing. Hey, listen, you and Moses and Bonds really get things going, the first three.
Yeah, I think the key to winning the ball game against Alabama tomorrow will be that if we get on base and everything goes well, we run and hit and run, and that's the key to winning.
All right, Otterby, can you sing in the rain?
I'm singing in the rain.
Hi, Jim.
They don't know too much about rain down there in Arizona, do they? That's a remarkably dry, beautiful state. Greg Shipley is 1-for-2, and the time they retired him, he lined the ball sharply to right field.
Potential passed ball that gets away from Pellegia. Here comes Hayes hustling in to cover home plate. Pellegia's good throw gets the runner Burrows from coming in.
Ball two to Shipley, who wants to get on. He represents the tying run, and the top of the batting order is due up.
His stride. We should watch that carefully.
Shipley, a switch hitter. Look at that. Got him. Just reared back after 3-0 and threw three fastballs right by. Strikeout. Check that second strikeout for Schiraldi.
Schiraldi really has an impressive fastball. He threw, and you can see there how far behind the ball Shipley was on that third strike. Blew it past him.
Kirk Killingsworth is down in the Texas bullpen. One out now. Elvin is up. He is 1-for-2. Walked, lined to center field, and singled.
Rain has made the footing rather uncertain, but Schiraldi seems to be overcoming it now.
Ooh, in under the chin. Elvin has power, 8 home runs, but noted for that leadoff, as we told you.
This is a close pitch. That ball looked like it sailed up and in, and he barely pulled his head out of the way in time.
14,029 paid their way in tonight. Many have gone because of the rain. That's too low. 7 hits, 3 errors for Texas. 3 runs, 6 hits, 1 error for Alabama. Last of the 7th. And yes, the rain continues to fall. And now I believe what's going to happen. They're going to call it. They're going to call it as the rain. Schiraldi doesn't want it to be called. He's standing on the mound and hasn't left yet. Schiraldi's saying, what's going on here? And now reluctantly leaves the mound. Just now reluctantly leaves the mound. Maybe he can remember what happened to Dean Hayes, who left with 2 out in an inning and only came back to get bombed. So, with 1 out in the 7th, the rain has come again to Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha, Nebraska. The count is 2-1 on Helmut. Nobody on base, and Texas leading this ball game in the battle of the unbeaten for the College World Series by a single run, 4-3. Second rain delay of the evening is over. Hopefully, there will not be a third. 1 out in the Alabama 7th. Alabama trending Texas 4-3. Brett Elvin, the batter, to face Calvin Schiraldi with a count 2-1. Before the play resumes, let's go down to Jim Price.
Hey, Jim, you know, during this last rain delay, I went in the Texas Longhorn dugout. They're a bunch of loosey-goosey guys. This is their first rain delay of the season. Let's go over to Handsome Irv Brown. Irv,
Well, that's not true, but thank you, Jim. Little information first off. Troy Brockley is warming up down in the bullpen to my right. He will be the new pitcher. He is a sinker baller for Alabama. I've got the man with the cigar, Frankie Mancuso, who's been the groundskeeper here forever. You told me a minute ago it is not going to rain anymore. We're going to get it in.
That's what the weatherman said. We're going to get it in no matter what happens.
Base paths are the biggest problem.
Oh, yeah. They're dry, and second base is dry, and mound and home plate's dry.
We are talking Major League Mosquitoes, though.
Well, with this heat we're going to have tomorrow night.
All right, Jim.
All right, here is Elvin. Alabama down by the run, with Barkley to relieve Hayes in the next inning, according to Irv. By the way, Frank does an outstanding job as a groundskeeper here, but Irv, I must also advise Frank Mancuso, it was the weatherman who says the rain is gone, who said we wouldn't get any rain. 20% chance is what he said in a northern Nebraska. However, let us hope he is right. Alvin Schiraldi in relief of Steve LeBay with a 1-1 lead. The go-ahead run scored on a double steal in the sixth inning with two out after our first rain delay. Count is 2-1, remember, to Alvin. 2-2. Standing back there, his team is down by a run. Whoever loses tonight is not out of the College World Series, but one more loss and they would be. Down ball, easy one hopper for Burrows, who makes the throw, takes Tolentino off the bag, but he holds on to the ball and makes the put up. Very quick inning after rain delay. No problem there for Giraldi. No runs, hits, there is none left. We've gone through seven complete with two rain delays of about an hour total time. Texas up by a run, and their pitcher Schiraldi looking mighty tough. Top of the eighth in a moment. This year it's on to a great golf course, Oakmont, Pennsylvania, outside of Pittsburgh, and we will broadcast live the first and second rounds of the U.S. Open Golf Championship starting June 16th. Note the times. 2:30 Eastern Time. Troy Brockley, that is not Troy, is in the game after Dean Hayes worked seven innings, gave up four runs, three of them earned, seven base hits, and walked two and struck out three. Brockley, the all-time Alabama leader in saves with 12. And he is in now with a one-run deficit. He's got to hold him and hope that against a very dangerous Calvin Schiraldi, his hard-hitting teammates can come back. And remember, Schiraldi will be facing the left-handers in the bottom of this inning, starting off with Magadan and Skates. Mike Brumley, 1-for-3 tonight, has driven in a run. Pitchers always comes in pressure situations. What does he think about?
Man, and expect me to throw strikes and not to walk anybody. Maybe get them to hit the ball on the ground, and that's all I try to do. Just make them hit the ball, and hopefully we'll get a double play.
Fouled upstairs. Again, a high pitch that Brumley could not handle. I like what Troy Brockley said, because what pitcher doesn't try to throw strikes and get them to hit the ball on the ground? Especially so when you're in a pressure situation, naturally. 4-3, Texas. Up high. Now remember, Texas has used LeBay tonight, using Schiraldi tonight, and yet sitting down ready to go tomorrow night if needed, or Capel, who's won 12 and lost one, or Clemens, who's won 12 and lost five, a number one draft pick. They are deep in pitching. Pitching can win a lot of ball games. 1-2 to Brumley. Foul upstairs. Derek Kindall called the possibility of a double steal back in the sixth inning with two out. Third and Sutton at first, and it worked. Here's a ground ball hit toward Lake, gobbles it up and throws on one hop. But again, Magadan this time digs it out, and Brumley is out.
Ball was a trifle wet. You can see Furman Lake there wiping his hand on his shirt, and that's going to be a problem in this wet field. He goes to his right well, gets in front of it, brings it up through the middle of his body to the belly button, controls the ball, throws over. It's in the dirt. Magadan stays in front, makes a good pickup.
Steve LeBay, who started this ball game and now is out, remained in as a designated hitter. He is hitting 294, has three home runs and 49 RBIs. And tonight pitched 4 2/3 inning and gave up three runs. All earned, five hits, struck out three and walked two. There's a strike to LeBay. In front of Valencia. Valencia had a ball get away from him and got a player trying to score from third base. But other than that, Frank has had a very calm evening. He has struck out, flied out, and grounded out. There's not been a force out there. Oh, good pitch. Good pitch. Ball out looking. Bay strikes out for the second try. Buckley's got his first strikeout.
It appeared that Troy Brockley dropped down to the side instead of coming overhand. Yes, he came down a little bit to the side, and it confused LeBay, the hitter. He slipped that breaking ball. It looked like a slider, Jim, and he was fooled, I think, as much by the motion as he was by the pitch.
Jose Tolentino, a couple weeks ago, became a U.S. citizen. He is from Mexico City. He is 0 for 2 tonight, but has a sacrifice fly and an RBI back in the first inning. Territory takes it. It's a count of 0-2.
Brockley at times will come over the top in a three-quarter overhand motion, and other times he'll drop down to the side a little bit, and that causes his fastball to sink away and in away from the left-handed hitter in that case.
Jim Price.
Hey guys, it's quite obvious down here that Brockley is throwing quite a bit harder than Steve Hayes did. Contrast comparable to Calvin Schiraldi coming in relief for LeMay.
There's one, and this is hit. Might be playable, and is not. He has got it. The hat goes off. I don't know whether he got that in fair foul territory. I think he's looking down the line. What do you think?
Right on the border.
Right on the border. In any event, Skates made the stop and the catch. No runs, hits, or errors. We're going to go away, and when we come back, Magadan and Skates, those two left-handers, will be looking at a right-hander for the first time tonight. And Alabama needs their bats. .539, had eight hits in his first eight at-bats in the College World Series, but he's 0 for 2 tonight, plus an intentional walk. And against the left-hander LeBay, David Magadan couldn't get the ball out of the infield, nor did he hit it very hard at all. But now he's got the right-hander Schiraldi out there in this 1-1 ball game. 2-0. And Rob Skates has also been rather ineffectual tonight. He's standing on deck.
It'd be a great deal to the Alabama offensive cause now to get this first runner on base. And if it were Magadan, he would give them a big lift because he's the offensive leader.
First right-hander and put it out. And there's little or no wind blowing at all. Tie game. That's just a flat-out home run to the opposite field.
Well, I mentioned mentioned a moment ago, to get on base would be important. Well, that's even better, of course. He touched the ball as he trotted around on the left field home run. Here's an example of an outstanding hitter. He took this pitch and went deep the other way. He uncoils and takes the low pitch and away from him and drives it deep into left field and over the fence. This young man is very, very impressive. Oh, what a cut. There it goes, disappearing over Johnny Sutton's head and over the left field fence for a tie game.
For all, we've had the two rain delays. Now we may have an extra inning game. Who knows? We could be here a long time in this one game night in Omaha, Nebraska, the College World Series. Rob Skates struck out twice, and his sacrifice fly has brought in one of the Alabama runs. And I think Calvin Chiraldi is a little shook.
Yes, and who wouldn't be? You don't expect a man to drive the ball that deep to the opposite field, but he hasn't faced a hitter like Magadan before either.
Fouled away. Let's go to Herb Brown.
All right, listen, I've got Dave Magadan. Dave, tell him the pitch that you hit.
It was a fastball low and away. I was looking for it, and just so happened he threw me one, and I was real fortunate he threw the pitch I was looking for.
Thank you, Dave.
Nice to win. Nice when you guess right. But he's got the sweet swing. The opposite field, that is a fair ball just inside the line. Sutton chasing it down. Skates on the way to second. And I tell you, the left-handers have been waiting all night long to see a right-hander. That's why Gustafson started LeBay in the first place. Now the winning run is in scoring position in the eighth inning with nobody out. And if they can pull it across, they would be three outs away from beating Texas.
Skates is holding his wrist because as he made the turn at first base, you can see he goes down, braces himself with the left hand, and gets up and hardly breaks stride and on to second base for his double. But that hurt. He put the entire weight of his body on that left arm as he fell to the ground. And it could be a sprain. We'll know next time he comes up to the plate in your previously called extra inning game, Jim. You see there, he scrambles to his feet and on his way.
Now let us see what happens. Alan Stallings is up. He is 1-for-3 plus a stolen base. And a base hit here. Are they going to go for it? Skates can run. Skates can hit as a double testify.
I think they call on Alan Stallings to bunt him over. This hard fastball at Chiraldi's ball.
Wow. He didn't on that pitch, may on the next pitch, but Valleggia, remember, has been handcuffed also, is standing by.
Good point, Jim, and maybe that's why Barry Schoenberger has elected to let Stallings hit away. Here in the last of the eighth, they need that runner on third base with less than two outs. Somehow, some way, he has to get him over.
Not bunting, but hit to the right side, foul. And now, 0-2, you know, if there ever was a thought of a bunt, they've dismiss that thought right now. 4-4, Texas and Alabama. Neither team has lost in this College World Series. Wow, got him on a high, hard one, and he needed that. As Stallings goes down with Chiraldi's fourth strikeout.
29.
Down there is Kirk Killingsworth. At one time, Jim Price told us, he's just loosening up. Maybe in for real now.
Here's a classic high fastball. This is a difficult pitch to hit. That's what your friend Sandy Koufax used to throw so effectively, Jim.
Uh-huh. Valleggia takes a rip at one. He's 0-for-3. Remember, only one man is out. Well, the Furman Lake may surprise me, but see that little man in there against this big Chiraldi, he might have a tough time. Right-hander to right-hander. Hard as Chiraldi throws. Have a quick bat to handle this man, as you've seen on the last three pitches. One to Stallings and the first two to Valleggia.
Well, perhaps Valleggia should shorten his stroke a little bit and just try to make contact with his fastball. He's not. He's going for the pump. That was a home run swing there, and they don't need that. They need a line drive base hit, something to score the runner from second with a go-ahead run in the eighth.
He's right down on the end of the bat. 1-2. Troy Brockley Everybody talking about the pressure being a relief pitcher. He's got it now. He's in a tie game. And I'm sure he'd rather be there than one down. Inside, it's 2-2.
The time where the batter has to shorten up and guard the plate. Try to get your bat on the ball. In a wet field, he could hit the ball and still he could get on base through an error or a bad throw.
Got him. Swinging. A home run swing again. And Schiraldi likes nothing better than they try to tee off on him. He'll overpower. Now here comes Lake. Now you know that Lake's not going to take the home run swing. There are two out now, and he's got to come up with a base hit or base on balls. Or the Texas Longhorns are out of it at 4-all on the home run by Magadan. Boy, he is throwing that baseball.
He's not messing around. He's not being cute. He's not trying finesse. He's going with the best pitch he has, and that's that high-velocity fastball.
Is 1-for-3 tonight. Last two times he's hit the ball well, single and lined out to the second baseman. After a rather poor display in this first time out, a weak one-handed swing to pop the ball to the right side. Oh, he wants the big one. Here I am saying Furman's going to shorten up. He wants the big one.
Well, I think you're right. He's wrong, Jim. He's not going to overpower this fastball. He simply has to make contact. And he's, oh, yes.
And look at Lake, 5-3, all the way down the end of the bat. Not shortening up at all on that last swing. Let's watch him closely here, see if he digs in and tries the same thing again. Got his one ball, two strikes, two outs. Skates at second base. He's been there since he doubled following Magadan's home run.
Have pretty well gone home now after the draft with their radar guns.
They tried and they failed, but the left-handers did well. Magadan with the home run to tie it, Skates double, but then the right-handers tried to tee off, and instead all three of them struck out swinging. One run, two hits, no errors, and Skates left down at second base. There's the score. After eight, it is Texas 4, Alabama 4, with Heron and Ray and Sutton due up. And Schiraldi, after giving up the home run, at least got his third strikeout at last. From here in Omaha in the College World Series, Michigan will play Texas, that's definite. And Alabama will play Arizona State, that's definite. Here's the catch. The winning team tonight will play the second game tomorrow night. And both games will be televised live on ESPN. Heron, the catcher, steps in to face Troy Brockley for the first time. 4-all, ninth inning. Gets to bat for the first time.
but Ray, right field.
Ray's only been to bat 51 times all year, hitting 176. And that was kind of a half swing after the ball was in the glove of Valencia. Strike one. Got that attitude of a good relief pitcher. He comes in, feels in control, just puts him in there. One ball, two strikes. Look at that. They have their rally caps that they turn around, meaning let's get something going. They're going to have to solve Broccoli. Gotten the hit off, and that's Brian Burrow. They better turn the caps around the other way.
Turn the bats around.
Since they've had it, two men have struck out swinging.
Broccoli has this nice little sinker going for him. When he comes down to the side, as he does there, you can see the ball actually dive in on the fists of the batter, Bud Ray. He's a sinker slider pitcher, and for a reliever, that's a pretty effective combination. You're going to throw a lot of ground balls, or you're going to surprise that hitter when he's not ready for it, and you're going to strike him out.
High ball game, ninth inning, two out. Throws that slider in there. Nothing. The way Broccoli delivers that ball to a right-hander, most of them are backing out of there as the ball is almost over the center of the plate. Johnny Keene Sutton did there. He laid down the bunt, and he was almost to first base before he chanced to look back. He was just going to beat it out. If it's foul, it's foul, but I'm not going to stay around and look and shorten my stride.
And a good ball player will do that, Jim. He won't take anything for granted. When he left the plate, he probably thought it would be foul, but he wasn't going to assume. Might kick back fair, hit a clump of dirt, and he was down across first base before he got the signal to come back and try again.
Is the home team. Scratch across a run, and they can take this thing. But wow. Oh, Barkley's on his way. But he doesn't have it. The runs are hard to come by in this game. After the home run to Magadan and the double to Skates, Schiraldi just buckled out and struck out Stallings, Valleggi, and Lake easily. But now we start the ninth inning for Texas, and Broccoli of Alabama is striking out three men in a row. Two swinging. Well, who's going to score? Whoever does probably will win this ball game. Last and ninth we go. Texas and Alabama, neither has lost. It is four apiece. Brown, Jim Price, we're all looking on with you at this winner's bracket game between Texas and Alabama. Schiraldi has struck out the last three in a row, and now he gets the 8-9 batters to start out the last of the ninth inning in this 4-4 ball game. Here's D. Smithy. He is 1-for-3, driven in a run and scored a run with a double in the fifth. In on the grass at third. Right field, Ray is out there and makes the catch. And that'll bring up Craig Shipley, who is 1-for-3 tonight.
22, Craig Shipley.
Shipley has faced Schiraldi one time and struck out swinging. He, like Brett Elbin, switch hits. And Elbin is the next man up.
Come on, Elbin!
Elbin in the on-deck circle has such a short name, he's got both his names. Not too many of these Alabama batters have been simply trying to make contact against Schiraldi. They've all been swinging from the heels.
Which is a mistake against that good fastball.
Now, into the stands to the left. One ball, two strikes. Ball game began about 3.5 hours ago, but they had two rain delays, one of 20 minutes, one of 42 minutes. And thus, in a rather low-scoring ball game, it has taken this long to play. And a well-pitched game. Inside, Schiraldi thought he had it. It's 2-2. Strikeout number 6 for Schiraldi, and remember, he just came on with 2 out in the 5th inning.
Top of the order, number 6.
This young man is throwing smoke. Shipley has very little chance on this ball. It was a fastball down low, had a little movement on it. Strike 3.
Red Elvin, the switch hitter. 1-for-3 tonight, plus a walk. He's got some power, and he shows it there. That is a tweener, and he's got some speed. It is off the wall in center field, picked up by Trent. And down to second goes Elvin with a double. The winning run is at second base with 2 out, and Ted McClendon, 1-for-4, due up.
Brett Elvin does have power, and he demonstrates it here. He has a long stride, a good stroke. The ball was up a little bit, and he finally got the bat out ahead of that fastball and doubled into deep right center field gap. And now McClendon is up with 2 outs, first base open. Do you think they'll walk him, Jim, intentionally?
Well, to get to Magadan? Are you kidding me?
Not likely.
Especially McClendon, remember, who has single, reached on an error, and grounded out twice, came into the ballgame hitting .376. Came into the College World Series from being the most valuable player in the Southern Regionals, which Alabama won. So he is very definitely a force to be reckoned with, and should he get a base hit with the speed of Elvin, this ball game could be over. Could. And Magadan waits for yet another chance. But there are 2 out. Off the corner, ball 1. Schiraldi thought he had that one.
McClendon showed good discipline there, because any hitter going up against Schiraldi should be looking for that fastball. And that's the most likely pitch they'll get. He threw a slider, and it was a close slider. McClendon very, very wisely laid off of it.
Fastball. Schiraldi is banging on every pitch now. Calvin thinks that Dale Williams is doing him wrong behind the plate.
Well, we can take a look ourselves here. We'll see that Schiraldi throws hard. He thinks it's a strike. Oh, does he ever. And we won't interpret through what he said there, but he was not too pleased with Dale Williams.
McClendon, a fastball hitter, and he's gotten one, but it was inside. The other was a slider outside, and that stays outside. It is 3-0, and you know what happens. The next man up is the man that hit the home run to tie the game. Magadan. And there is David Magadan. Got the low away fastball and pumped it over the left field wall to tie the game at 4. And that's where we are now in the last of the night. Up high and on 4 pitches, 2 of which Schiraldi, I'm sure, thought the bad calls. And now Gustafson is coming out, and that may be all for Schiraldi, although no one is warming up. Killingsworth has been warming up.
He could bring Killingsworth in. I think he is loose, as you point out, Jim. But on the other hand, I don't think he will take Schiraldi out. He's still his best pitcher. He's going out to soothe his nerves, tell him, calm down, Calvin. That's all right. The umpire's
entitled
to miss
one. How about also turn to tell him how he pitched to Magadan last time, and don't throw that same kind of pitching today, reminding him of how to work this man, because Magadan has been hurt off the fist, but that was by LeBay, a left-hander. Schiraldi's a whole different ballgame.
That's right. And Calvin Schiraldi has dug himself a pretty deep hole here. That was a very unintentional walk to Ted McClendon. He did not want to walk the right-handed hitter McClendon and have to face the nation's leading hitter with 2 outs in the ninth and a tie game. But that's exactly what he did. Now, he's going to have to call up the very best stuff he has and try to get out Magadan.
A number one draft choice in the recent draft against a number two draft choice in the recent draft. A great pitcher for Texas against the leading hitter, as you have said, Jerry, in all of college baseball this year in Division I. So let's see what happens. The matchup begins now. Down at second base is Elvin after the double, and on at first is McLendon after the walk on four pitches. Up high, very high, one ball, one strike. Should Chiroldi lose Magadan to load him up, skates the last time up, drilled a double down the left field arm.
See now for ourselves if that bat crossed home plate and Randy Crystal at third base made the proper call. Indeed he did. That vindicated or justified the umpire's call clearly. That was a strike.
Well, Chiroldi out ahead of Magadan, 1-2. Winning run down at second base. Two out in the ninth. Jerry, you gotta love it. There's a man in your picture there with all the talent in the world and a good big fastball at the plate. No place better would David Magadan like to be right now than where he is. One may fail. One certainly will fail, and the other will be successful. But both are thrilled to be where they are at the moment. And it goes to Chiroldi. Magadan strikes out. Strikeout number 7 for Chiroldi. We go to extra innings. No run, one hit, no errors. Two men left on, including Elvin, the winning run. Down at second base, where he was with two out, and Magadan could not bring him in. Up the 10th inning for Texas in this 4-4 ball game against Fred Barkley. Attention centered now on the pitchers, Barkley of Alabama and Chiroldi of Texas. Short change, Calvin, for a moment there. I said he had 7 strikeouts. He's got 8 strikeouts. And remember that Barkley struck out the last 3 men he faced in the 9th inning, and 4 of the last 5 men he has struck out. One ball, one strike to Trent. Barkley's a little bit different than Chiroldi. Of the 4 men he struck out of the last 5 he's faced, 2 have been caught looking, and 2 have been caught swinging. Down ball, chance for Lake at second base. Can't get a handle on the ball, and that just might open the floodgates right there.
Tough play for Furman Lake. The ball was hit sharply up the middle by Trent. And maybe the grass being wet had an effect here, or the dirt being a little slippery and skittish, and Lake wasn't able to handle that ball cleanly. I think probably the ball hit that grass and took off as a rock would across a smooth pond.
Texas has been in 4 extra games this year and has won them all. The bunt is fouled. And the bunter is Brian Burrow, the number 9 man in the slot, trying to set things up for Bates and Brumley to put Texas ahead. We started out with better than 14,000 people, but the two rain delays have us down to a few thousand. And they're missing a fine ball game. Now an extra inning.
I believe Burroughs will try to sacrifice bunt again. This situation is so crucial. He's the 9th hitter in the lineup. Leads the Texas team in sacrifices. There he goes.
Popped it up, however, and Bellegio misses where it went, but I don't think he would have gotten to it anyway. Too shallow, back to the screen. Two strikes, and now the bunt may be taken off here. You would think it would be taken off, but you never know with the number 9 batter and a man who can handle the bat as Burrow can. So we'll see what happens. And Elvin is guessing right along with us. He's in on the grass at third. And Magadan holding at first. No, he's going to swing. And this is going to go to Shipley. Gets it to Lake. Lake back not in time. Burrow is safe at first on the force. One out.
Trent going hard into second base prevented Lake from getting a strong throw off on the pivot and allowed Burrows to make it to first base safely. Here we have a better look at it. Off the base, he catches the ball, but he doesn't get a lot on the throw because he has to avoid the sliding runner, Trent.
Bill Bates walked and scored in the first, tripled and scored in the third, and since then has fouled out and grounded to first. They're looking for Bunt again, but he's swinging away. Both Magadan, also cautiously, and Elvin on the dead run were closing from first and third. The speed of Burrow at first base, he's tried to steal nine times, has been successful five. Off the corner, one ball, one strike. 4-4, Texas and Alabama. Go ahead.
Excuse me. In this situation, we just saw the third baseman, Fred Elvin, close on the line to prevent any ball from going to his right.
And that's going to go down there and in the left field corner. Burrow is on his way to third. Skates has a tough time coming up with it, and it's 5-4, Texas. Double by Bates, a big man tonight.
Hope to prevent an extra base hit with the lead run on first base. And that's why the third baseman, Elvin, was guarding the line so closely a moment ago. But Bates drilled the ball over his head. Line drive down the left field line. Once it hit that wet grass, it just took off like a bullet. And into the corner where we see Skates, the left fielder, tracking it down. And he can't find the handle. Finally comes up with it. By that time, it's much too late to get the speedy Burrows coming around to score.
Schallenberger has not gone to his bullpen. After all, his best man is out on the mound right now. Brumley, 1-for-4 tonight, has driven in a run. What about Alabama in the 10th? Skates, Stallings, and Valencia. But first things first, if Alabama's to stay in a ballgame, Barkley has to shut down Texas here. On a count of 0-2 to Mike Brumley. One ball, two strikes.
Just scored on the double brings back the hard aggressive slide of Mike Trent in the second base that prevented the double play a moment ago.
Oh, it's off the glove of Magadan, and it's going to be a 2-1 ball. It goes riding on home. There's the play at second, and they've got him at second base. But another run scores. Bates comes home. Brumley gets a single off the glove.
Brumley's very, very happy that he got the base hit to drive in that second run in the inning, but he's very upset at this call at second base. Now we'll get a chance to look at it to see if he's safe or out. The umpire, Dick Runchy, calls him out, and Mike Brumley has a word or two to say about it. Here's the relay. Good relay from the right fielder into the second baseman, and he cuts it off and throws it to the shortstop. Out, says the umpire. Brumley begs to differ, but the umpire prevails.
LeBay takes a slider for a strike. LeBay started this ballgame for Texas as the pitcher. The last two times up, he has struck out looking and takes a call strike there. One ball, one strike, two out. And 6-4. Down ball, and here comes Barkley. Bare hand, the throw, and he's got the man. Good play. But two-run score. three base hits. No errors and nobody left. And now Alabama, with a chance to win it in the ninth inning, has to come back with two runs just to tie it in the last of the tenth, or the Crimson Tide will lose their first, and Texas, number one in the nation, would remain undefeated. There's Brumley. He still doesn't like that call. Texas, which took the early lead, has done the same thing. The Tide is down by two, but it's in the 10th inning. And they're going against Schiraldi, who has struck out eight men since coming on in the 5th inning. But Skates doubled what he faced him last time. Skates, Stallings, and Valleggia, the 4, 5, 6 hitters. And they're swinging again. Skates, 1 for 3. Six to four. Alabama has won both of its games by the score of 6-5. There have been 5 6-5 games in this College World Series. Texas won one of its, a very hotly contested extra inning game over Oklahoma State, 6-5. But this is 6-4, and Skates is still swinging for the fences.
Alabama desperately needs a base runner here somehow, some way, to bring that tying run up to the plate.
Two balls, two strikes. The Alabama bench, they may be going down to their first defeat. Remember, they've won their last 15 in a row. Will not be out of it whoever loses this ball game, because you've got to lose twice. So the scenario could be, if Texas won, that perhaps both Texas and Alabama could win tomorrow night, and then on Saturday, should Texas win, they would be the champions. If Alabama win, they'd have to play Sunday. All kinds of possibilities. That's not a forecast, just a reminder that a lot of things can still happen. There's the strikeout, number 9. As far as that's concerned, the two teams not playing tonight, Michigan and Arizona State, each of them could win this World Series.
Oh, yes. Very, very possible. He throws the ball right past Skates, and Skates is a good fastball hitter, but Schiraldi really has it tonight. That ball is taking off. That high fastball has a little something extra on it that actually causes it to rise a bit.
Alan Stallings. The batter. Six-four, Texas, number one in the nation, and what quite a pitching staff. They were the favorites coming in here. To Omaha. And they've had a scare in their second game, and they've had a scare tonight, but they may emerge unscathed. One ball, two strikes. Stallings has faced Schiraldi twice and has struck out swinging against Schiraldi twice. Last out, first man he faced in the 5th inning, and then again in the 8th. And strike, well, that's strike 2, 1 ball, 2 strikes. Texas in its 23rd College World Series. There haven't been too many of them. And Alabama in its 2nd.
Rosenblatt Stadium, the last of the 10th inning. You can see Schiraldi here on this replay. It tells it all. He's really got confidence. He's keyed up.
Got him.
Get him out of there.
Valleggia is still swinging. He is 0-for-4 tonight, has struck out looking on a changeup thrown to him by LeBay back in the 2nd inning, and swinging at a high, hard one thrown by Schiraldi in the 8th inning. like Arizona State, like Michigan, has more chances. It's not over. Two balls, one strike. And Heron doesn't want Schiraldi to lose Valencia and bring the winning run to the plate. Or the tying run to the plate, beg your pardon.
Yes, Jeff Heron, a very experienced, soothing, confident kind of catcher, just trotted out to remind his pitcher, look, you've got guys behind you. You're not the only man out there in the field. You don't have to strike out everybody, Calvin. Just throw strikes now. Maybe we can do a hand to help you.
How do you think the Mets feel tonight about this man, picking him number one in the draft? Oh, 2-2. Fouled upstairs, I do believe. I don't think that Heron can get to that one. He cannot. We're going to name our most valuable player should the game end here, because remember, Alabama is still alive, and you will be surprised, I'll clue you, it is not Schiraldi, because the game goes 10 innings, not the five that he's been in there. He has done an outstanding job with 10 strikeouts already, but we have somebody else in mind.
Somebody richly deserving of the award.
And we'll let you know should the game end here. If it does not, then we'll have to regroup.
Another vote, maybe.
Strikes out the side in the 10th. Texas remains undefeated. They are 3-0. Alabama 2-1. Texas are the only undefeated team now in the College World Series. The most valuable player is the second baseman of Texas, Bill Bates. Walked and scored in the first. Tripled and scored in the third. Doubled and scored in the 10th. But he hit the go-ahead run. Drove it in the 10th inning also with his double. He drove in the 5th run and scored the 6th run himself. Tomorrow, remember, there will be 2 games. Alabama will be facing Arizona State at 6 o'clock Eastern time, to be followed by undefeated Texas against Michigan. And those games will be live and will all be here. I'm Jim Simpson with Jerry Kindall, along with Jim Price and Herb Brown. It has been an outstanding night, marred only by the rain, 2 rain delays. But Texas remains undefeated on the play of Bates and the pitching of Schiraldi. And for Texas and their coach, Cliff Gustafson, they've got to be saying, hey, folks, we are so excited.
I'm so excited, and I just can't hide.
Flies to Tokyo.